Thank you. That concludes topical questions. We'll move on to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion 4576 in the name of Fiona Hyslop on inclusive tourism, promoting accessible tourism and changing lives through the visitor economy. I'd invite members who wish to speak to press their request to speak buttons now. And I call on Fiona Hyslop to speak to and move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And as we mark the beginning of National Tourism Week tomorrow, I move the motion in my name. Since taking up my role as Cabinet Secretary for Tourism last year, I have spoken many times about what tourism means for Scotland's prosperity. I have spoken about the £11 billion of economic activity that it generates in the wider supply chain. I've spoken about the importance of Scotland's place in Europe. Seven of our top 10 key markets are European and in the wider world. And I have welcomed the significant increase in the jobs that the industry provides, 217,000 in 2015, which is 8.5% of all of Scotland's employment. All of these are good, sound reasons to be proud of our vibrant and successful tourism industry. The tourism industry continues to grow, and those who come to visit us are drawn to Scotland for a wide variety of reasons. They want to see our exceptional natural landscapes, visit our award-winning attractions, and taste our wonderful food and drink. But Scotland's economic strategy is not only about delivering sustainable economic growth, it is also about tackling the inequalities that continue to exist in our society. And unfortunately, those inequalities are still very real for many people. We often say about our industry that tourism is everyone's business, and we have made great progress in making that so, but tourism is not yet for everyone. One in every three people in Scotland misses out on being a visitor in their own country. And we want to change that, and we are. I'm sure everyone in this chamber can think about a holiday or even a day out that was special for them. Something that brings back a fond memory or a smile when you think about it. Time with my grandparents in a caravan on the shores of Loch Doon was very special to me as a child, as I made mine Loch Doon Castle, the ruins of Loch Doon Castle, in exploration when all the day visitors had left. Some of you may also be familiar with the annual Glasgow Taxi Association's annual day out to Troon. Now, believe it or not, these trips began in 1945 with only three taxi drivers, and they're now 150. And since then, countless Glasgow children have been able to enjoy the delights of the Ayrshire coast, a wonderful example of what inclusive tourism is all about. Last February, the First Minister launched Visit Scotland's new Spirit of Scotland campaign, which introduced a brand new approach to promoting Scotland around the world. At the launch, she highlighted the new partnership between Visit Scotland and the Family Holiday Association. The aim then was to create the ScotSpirit programme of around 100 short breaks for disadvantaged families from across Scotland. In September, I launched a second project, the Glasgow Pilot, to provide days out for disadvantaged families living in the Glasgow area. At that launch, I found out that, difficult as it is to believe, some families from the outlying parts of Glasgow never visit the city centre. I also met with some of the families who took part in the ScotSpirit Breaks. One was a single mother of two who had to give up work due to a relationship breakdown and to deteriorating physical and mental health. Another had moved to Scotland from Nigeria, where she had her own business and was back at college trying to improve her employability while her young daughter was at nursery. And both families enjoyed weekend breaks, one in Inverness-shire and the other in Ayrshire. Now, just over a year on from that initial launch, we did not imagine the success it would achieve in such a short time. Not just in the number and quality of the breaks that were provided, but also in the generosity of the industry in providing those opportunities for so many families. Overall, 250 families benefited from both programmes, nearly 1,000 people in total, and 555 of these were children. And more than half of these families had never had a break together at all. This was a truly collaborative initiative across all parts of the industry, from Historic Environment Scotland to Largs Putting Green, from Abellio ScotRail to Boots and Paddles, a mobile outdoor adventure company, from Hilton Hotels to the Bean and Leaf, an Ayrshire cafe bistro, providing a range of experiences that the families who took part will remember for a very long time, and that could very well change their lives. Resilience is very important, and coming together at difficult times to have that time away can make a real difference to how people see themselves, their relationships, and their capacity perhaps to move on from difficult situations. European partnership has also been a part of making the programmes a success. In January, I heard it firsthand about the work of Visit Flanders, which has been developing social tourism since 2001. Now, from helping 752 individuals then, it now helps around 150,000 people a year to have a break. Quite phenomenal. Visit Flanders has recorded a range of social benefits from its social tourism initiatives, including increased citizenship and improvements to well-being, self-esteem and family relationships. And in enabling an additional 150,000 people to take a break, it has helped support the tourism industry, often in low season when many businesses are struggling to stay open and employ staff. Through the signing of its renewed Memorandum of Understanding with Visit Scotland, both organisations will continue to share best practice and expertise on a number of topics, including social tourism. Like those families who took part in our ScotSpirit Breaks, Presiding Officer, another group who can benefit from the inclusive tourism agenda are carers. As a government, we already recognise the vital role that unpaid carers and young carers play in our society. And we know that caring can be a positive and rewarding experience and can have a positive impact on well-being. But it is also crucial that carers are supported effectively to enable them to better cope with the stresses and demands of their caring role and to look after their own health and well-being. And that includes taking a much-needed break. From the 1st of April 2018, the new Carers Scotland Act 2016 will make a meaningful difference to unpaid carers and will contribute towards the improvement of their health and well-being, ensuring that they can continue to care if they wish to and to have a life alongside caring. And it places a duty on local authorities to provide support to carers based on the carer's identified needs, and there is a requirement for the responsible local authority to consider whether support should be provided in a form of a break from caring. It will also mean that each local authority will, under a duty to prepare and publish a short break services statement, which sets out information on the breaks available in Scotland for the carer and cared for person. President Officer, I'd like now to talk about respitality. Now, the respitality initiative, that is respite breaks plus hospitality, also already connects local carers centres with hospitality providers such as hotels, guest houses, leisure clubs and restaurants. And the aim is that providers become respitality partners by offering a gift of a short break to a carer or young carer. The pilot project, originally included Dumfries and Galloway, Falkirk, Fife, Midlothian and North and South Lanarkshire, and that was extended in 2016 to also include Angus, Dundee, Edinburgh and Perth and Kinross. And developed and administered by Shared Care Scotland, one of our national carer organisations, in partnership with Scottish Government officials and Hospitality Industry Trust Scotland, we have provided funding amounting to £123,000 towards the pilot since 2014. And an evaluation report published in January with findings and recommendations for future provision is currently being considered. In addition, since 2010, the Scottish Government has also provided funding of over £20 million towards the voluntary run Short Breaks Fund, administered by Shared Care Scotland and the Family Fund. And these three programmes provide grants to third sector organisations to develop new and existing short breaks provisions to provide choice, flexibility and personalisation of services, and also directly to the families of disabled children and young people to support their breaks or activities. But inclusive tourism is not just about providing opportunities like those I have just mentioned. For those who live with disability in Scotland, taking a simple break can also be challenging. Like our country, Scotland's population is diverse, with disabled people making up nearly one in five of Scotland's working age population. And as we know, our population is also ageing. Euan's Guide, in partnership with Visit Scotland through its inclusive tourism programme, is an excellent example of how we're making tourism in Scotland available to everyone. And work to improve access can improve the experiences of a wide range of visitors, from families with young children and senior travellers to people with permanent physical or sensory disabilities. And access guides and accessible itineraries of things to do and see for visitors are available through visitscotland.com, providing a range of information on accessible holidays in Scotland. And last Sunday, on Disabled Access Day, this very building, which scores 4.5 stars, presiding officer, in Euan's Guide, and has its own access statement, offered BSL guided tours for visitors and hosted entertainment from the Edinburgh Signing Choir. So as well as tackling inequalities, the accessibility of tourism products and services has real potential to boost the wider economy by actively supporting the local communities in the areas with accessible tourism business. For example, in North Berwick with its beach wheelchair access facility. In 2015, the Great British Tourism Survey reported that tourism parties in which at least one member was identified as having a disability contributed approximately £1.3 billion to Scotland's economy. So that's a sizeable contribution by any measure. And Visit Scotland is working hard this year to take the agenda further with the introduction of two new accessible tourism destination areas, hashtag Accessible Fife and Everyone's Edinburgh, including a basic assessment of accessibility actions during its quality assurance visits and developing new guides on inclusive events, inclusive design to support building refurbishment and development, and an inclusive communications guide. So the benefits that even a short break can bring cannot be underestimated, and they can be economic, educational, and social. The Family Holiday Association has identified a wide range of such benefits. For business, breaks can reduce the impact of seasonality by filling capacity during low or shoulder season months and create and maintain employment levels both in the tourism sector and the wider economy. And they also provide free marketing and to help to provide and develop an improved corporate reputation. A higher number of breaks can provide support for small and emerging destinations and boost regional investment in accommodation, retail, transport, hospitality, attractions, and the cultural sector. And they can also promote a destination's tourism potential to the wider public. And people who participate in tourism at an early age are more likely to do so as an adult, supporting longer-term sustainability. So enabling people to take breaks can also reduce pressure on health services through the improved mental and physical well-being of participants. There can be a reduced reliance on social services with fewer applications for unemployment and other state benefits. And for those in work, a break can support better performance and less likelihood of burnout. Participants also report improved family cohesion and a higher level of life satisfaction and self-esteem. And there could also be a positive impact on the ability to learn and desire to undertake a personal development. And so many of us probably take our holiday time or our breaks for granted. But what we're talking about is the opportunity for people who perhaps might not have that opportunity to actually experience something that we, as I said, can often take for granted. So at the broadest level, enabling more people to take a break can improve social cohesion, participation in community life, and engagement with education and employment. I wonder, President Officer, if we can be as ambitious as Visit Flanders to go to 150,000 people, which is part of the fabric of the life of their society and economy, is certainly a wonderful example. And I think something we can and should think about aspiring to. So that is, I hope, President Officer, an explanation of the importance of this sector. I think it's something we can learn from other countries, but also, I think, lead on. And there are so many very good examples. I'm not making any claims that we have a totally inclusive or accessible tourism sector as of now, but I think with shared ambition, that is something that we can aspire to. And there are not many things in life where there is a win-win outcome. Inclusive tourism, be it increasing accessibility, giving disadvantaged families and individuals a break, or supporting growth in our sector, is actually one of those things that helps the individuals, and helps the sector. I look forward to the contributions from everybody in this chamber, and I hope this can be a shared endeavour that we can lead on as part and behalf of the people of Scotland. And so, Presiding Officer, I ask members to support the motion.
Thank you. I call on Dean Lockhart to speak to move the motion in his name.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's a pleasure to take part in today's debate. The debate is a timely opportunity to discuss the importance of inclusive tourism, both for the positive impact it has in improving the lives of many people in Scotland, and also the substantial economic benefit it brings to Scotland. Today's debate is also timely because, as the Cabinet Secretary mentioned, this week marks Scottish Tourism Week, and there are many reasons to be positive about the tourist sector in Scotland. There are now more than 217,000 people working in the industry, an increase of more than 10% year on year. Tourist spend in Scotland generates over £12 billion of economic activity in the wider Scottish supply chain and contributes some £6 billion to Scottish GDP. This represents about 5% of total Scottish economic contribution, showing how important the tourist sector is to the economy. It's also one of the fastest growing sectors in the economy, with growth in tourist spend of approximately 15% last year. Tourists from the rest of the UK contributed the vast majority of tourist spend in Scotland, while the largest single overseas market comprised tourists from the United States, showing that the Scottish tourist market is reflective of the overall Scottish economy, with the rest of the UK market being the most important, followed by our relationship with the United States. Social tourism is now an important part of the overall growth of the tourist sector in Scotland. In 2015, tourism groups in which at least one member was identified as having a disability contributed some £1.3 billion to Scotland's economy. This is approximately 20% of total spending on day visits in Scotland. Our amendment to the government's motion today, which we will be supporting, recognises that this growing importance of social tourism is something that we should capitalise upon. And it also, our amendment to the motion also supports the further promotion of Scotland as an accessible visitor destination for all tourists from other parts of the UK and worldwide. Recognising the social and economic benefits to be derived from inclusive tourism, Visit Scotland is working to expand inclusive tourism in two main areas. First of all, accessible tourism. This involves working with industry and promoting the business case for those with specific access requirements to visit places and gain experiences that might not otherwise be available to them. And secondly, social tourism, which enables those from disadvantaged backgrounds to experience a trip to another part of Scotland. Again, something they might not otherwise benefit from. In the area of accessible tourism, Visit Scotland has rightly identified potential for significant development. There are 11.6 million people in the UK with a disability. That's approximately 18.5% of the total population. And it is estimated that as many as four out of five people with a disability do not enjoy a holiday, something that many of us take for granted. And I'm sure all members today will agree that this is something that is worthy of improvement. To address this, it's important that we also remember that accessibility is limited for a large number of people who have visual impairment, hearing impairment or learning disabilities, as well as physical disabilities. The accessible tourism market also includes the provision of tourist facilities for families with young children, elderly people, people with mental health issues, and people with temporary physical impairments. So it's clear that this is a very wide market with wide appeal. In order to expand this market, Visit Scotland has recognised a number of different access barriers that prevent people from having a holiday or a break with their family. An understanding of these barriers has helped the sector better understand how to open up the visitor economy to as many people as possible. Yes, of course.
Cabinet Secretary.
The member talks about the different ranges of disabilities and the need to tackle barriers. I think it's very interesting that 71% of disabilities are non-visible. So therefore, the accessibility guides that he talks about can help perhaps open people's awareness of the types of measures they might need to take.
Dean Lockhart.
Thank you. I completely agree. And thank you for raising that point. And Visit Scotland has, as I will come on to later, introduced specific training programmes to address the needs of people who have special access requirements, and also to provide training to tourist operators so that they can identify what those needs are. So I think it's a very good point to highlight. And the barriers that we do need to highlight, and which have been highlighted by Visit Scotland, include physical barriers, concerns that people with impaired mobility may not be able to access facilities, buildings or a physical landscape. Technology barriers, as we know, holiday or accommodation bookings are increasingly being booked online, and this can prove challenging for some people to arrange bookings. And there is still limited information available on accessible visitor sites in Scotland. Presiding officer, a number of successful measures have been taken by the tourist sector to break down these barriers. Visit Scotland suggests that there are three core aspects that businesses need to address to expand access in a meaningful way. First of all, training their staff to be disability aware. Secondly, provision of detailed information on access levels on websites and brochures. And thirdly, making sure physical facilities are fit for expanded access. And I'm very glad to say that these needs are being addressed. First of all, Visit Scotland, as I mentioned, is arranging for specific training for managers and frontline staff of tourist accommodation so that they are aware of the requirements of tourists who require specific access needs. In addition, organisations such as Euan's Guide work with the public sector to make sure that information is available on sites that are accessible to all members of the public, something that is to be commended. Let me move on to the second element of social inclusive tourism, and that is social tourism. The expanding area of social tourism reflects that some 250,000 families in Scotland are unable to take a short break because they either cannot afford the cost or are unable to take time off because of care or other commitments. The barriers to social tourism differ from the barriers to accessible tourism. In the case of social tourism, it may be family or social barriers where the personal or financial position of an individual or family makes it difficult to afford the trip or the cost involved, or indeed the time involved in having, having a family trip. Given this, social tourism involves facilitating access to short breaks for the most disadvantaged in society. To achieve this, collaboration across the tourist sector is required, and there have been notable success stories. As the Cabinet Secretary has mentioned, in last year, Visit Scotland, in a collaboration with the Family Holiday Association and many industry partners, combined to provide two initiatives that enabled over 250 vulnerable and disadvantaged families in Scotland to take a short break or a day trip in Scotland that otherwise they would not have been able to do. This resulted in providing some over 1,000 people with an experience of Scotland that otherwise was not possible. These initiatives provided weekend breaks across Scotland and also included families visiting the wider Glasgow area to enjoy a day away from their routine stresses, which has been highlighted as being something that is very good for the individuals involved. I would commend everyone involved in these initiatives for their forward thinking and generosity of time and resource in making these initiatives happen. Presiding officer, these initiatives are good examples of how collaboration across the tourist sector can deliver results and of how it is possible to combine the social dimension and also have a positive business outcome. For example, an increasing number of these visits are taking place during the low season of the tourist season, meaning that social tourism can increase occupancy and assist tourist business during quiet times. I would now like to conclude by highlighting an example of an organisation in my own region that exemplifies many of the values of inclusive tourism that we will be discussing today. Trossachs Mobility is a registered charity based in Callander, which aims to break down the barriers that disabled people often face when it comes to exploring the great outdoors. This initiative provides specialised all-terrain wheelchairs designed for the most difficult of outdoor terrains. By making access to our national parks easier for people with disabilities and other physical limitations, Trossachs Mobility allows disabled people to enjoy the Scottish countryside and give individuals a sense of independence that normal wheelchairs cannot offer. A partnership with Stirling Cycle Hub has recently enabled the charity to create a link with the families of disabled people who can cycle alongside their family members in the all-terrain chairs. This is a great example of social inclusion, as without this service, these families would not be able to access the great outdoors. Trossachs Mobility benefits from continued support by Stirling Council and the Loch Lomond and Trossachs National Park, and this will help the initiative to continue to grow, and I wish them very well for the future. Presiding Officer, during this debate today, we will hear from my colleagues and other members of the Chamber about how inclusive tourism is able to address the issues of social responsibility by expanding the enjoyment of having a break away from everyday pressures and, at the same time, business growth by creating opportunities to meet the demands of many people who have previously been excluded from the market. While there has been limited regulatory intervention to encourage and increase the availability of accessible tourist sites across Scotland, as we have heard, these initiatives are most successful when they are sector-led, involving collaboration across many different peoples and organisations involved in the sector, and when they have a strong business case as well as social benefits to be derived. I congratulate everyone in the tourist sector who have worked together to promote inclusive tourism in Scotland, and I move the amendment in my name. Thank you.
Thank you. I call on Lewis MacDonald to speak to move the amendment in his name.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I was pleased to see the reference to Euan's guide in the government's motion today. I first met Euan MacDonald a couple of years ago at a parliamentary reception to which I was invited by the late and much missed Gordon Aikman, whose campaigning achievements we celebrated here a few weeks ago. Euan is a power chair user who was diagnosed with motor neuron disease back in 2003, and I was delighted to meet him again last week when he was here with his sister Kiki to promote the disabled access events over the weekend to which the ministers referred. Euan, like Gordon, met a life-changing condition by seeking to achieve change in society. His starting point was that it was difficult to find accessible places to go, even just for a coffee with friends. And so he set up Euan's Guide, and that is a fantastic example of collective action online. It is disabled people themselves, it is and their families and their carers who write the reviews and who put those up there. And it is other people facing the same challenges who read them and take advantage of them. I hope many more people will add their tuppence worth to that guide so that accessible venues and visitor attractions across Scotland are promoted and publicised, and all venues are encouraged to meet the standards of the best, including this Parliament itself. Mark Cooper is another wheelchair user turned campaigner who has used his own campaigning energies to secure a change in the law to require pubs and restaurants to be accessible. Like many activists, Mark was spurred on by his own experience. After going for a drink with friends in an Edinburgh pub, he had to leave midway through the evening when he discovered that the only toilet he could use was up some stairs he could not climb. And it was his energy and commitment which helped to secure a change to the Criminal Justice and Licensing Act in 2010, requiring those seeking to obtain or renew a license to serve alcohol to show how they have made their premises accessible. That new requirement, however, has still not been brought into force, and I believe it is time for that to change. Our amendment today highlights the need for the Scottish Government to ensure that the change in the law is now implemented. Ministers have had over 5 years to consider necessary changes to secondary legislation. I have no doubt they have done that. Now I think they need to get on with implementing the will of Parliament. Another formidable campaigner for the rights of disabled people is Daeman Begg, formerly MP for Aberdeen South and nowadays an active member of the Aberdeen Disabled Action Group, which advises the City Council on policy as it affects disabled people. Anne's view is that tourist destinations in general are much better geared up now than was the case generally 20 years ago for disabled visitors in general, but that a great unmet need still exists for those who are the most severely disabled. A good example of that kind of issue is raised by the Changing Places campaign, which campaigns for bespoke public conveniences for those who need to lie rather than sit down in order to get changed while on a day out. Anne Begg is very supportive of the campaign for such facilities at Aberdeen Beach, started by local nurse and mum Judith Schofield, and enjoying active cross-party support. That example illustrates the point that improved access for a disabled person can also allow that person's family to enjoy a day out where they might not otherwise be able to do so, and also the point that the visitor attraction itself gets a benefit from increased visitor numbers and the increased spending that goes with that. So for in that case, more users of Aberdeen Beach will mean more income for the businesses on the beachfront, and improved facilities for the most disabled will usually mean better facilities for everyone else as well. And it's a point recognised also by the National Museum of Scotland, which I know is seeking to respond positively to a similar campaign by changing places around their facilities there. But of course, as we've already heard, accessible tourism is not only about removing physical barriers to holiday destinations for disabled people and others, it is also about lowering the financial and social barriers which can equally prevent access to what our country has to offer. So we do welcome the work of Visit Scotland and the ScotSpirit campaign to promote social tourism, which is another important aspect of an inclusive approach to holidays in Scotland. And the Family Holiday Association mentioned already has highlighted that a lack of access to the experience of holidays is one of the consequences of poverty in Scotland. According to the Office of National Statistics, almost a third of families cannot afford a week's holiday. As many as 200,000 Scottish children live in families which cannot afford a day out. And the Family Holiday Association has been doing something about that across the UK for 40 years. It's good that we've seen this new initiative in Scotland to extend the work that they do with support from businesses, large and small. And those taking advantage include families short of cash. The Minister gave an example of marital breakdown, but also those struggling with the impact of bereavement or domestic violence or substance abuse. And one of the striking things about their testimonies is what a difference even a short break can make to people's lives in those circumstances. It is remarkable that even in the 21st century, a third of Scottish households have still not experienced the joys of a holiday in Scotland. That is a measurement of the number of people for whom inclusive tourism is still an aspiration rather than a fact. But it also reflects an unreached market as far as Scottish tourism businesses are concerned. Holiday opportunities for disadvantaged families require willing participation by those businesses too. And their feedback is also interesting. They all regard it as a way of meeting their corporate social responsibility. Two-thirds of them hoped for additional visitor numbers as a result. Three-quarters thought they were good for the image and reputation of the sector as a whole. But every single one of them recognised that they made a real difference to the families in question, and that for every single one of them was part of the reason for taking part. So in promoting accessible and inclusive tourism, there are all sorts of barriers which need to be addressed. A variety of partners need to be involved. Some already are, others need to be too. But places like science centres, art galleries, museums, local authorities, Historic Environment Scotland, Events Scotland, Visit Scotland, all have a role to play here, as do travel companies, service providers, and visitor attractions and their staff. But the driver in future, as in the past, will, I have no doubt, continue to come from those voluntary groups and committed individuals, from Euan's Guide to the Family Holidays Association, from Mark Cooper and Anne Begg to the Changing Places campaign, those people who themselves see what the barriers are and set out to remove them. The job of government and its agencies and of this Parliament as well is to get behind those campaigners, because their successes will be good for all of us. And to that end, I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you. I now call on Tavish Scott to speak to and move amendment 4576.3 in his name.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And firstly, can I apologise for the state of my voice, which is a direct result of being a tourist to Liverpool, or more accurately to Anfield on Sunday, and the necessity of raising my voice on the odd occasion so as to ensure the desired result. And it certainly hasn't recovered yet. It feels nearly worse than watching Scotland-England on Saturday, which didn't do much for my voice either. Can I broadly commend the remarks of the Cabinet Secretary in opening this debate? Actually, funny enough, I thought this debate was sure to be truncated today, because we would surely be having a full statement from the First Minister on what she announced, not to Parliament yesterday, but to the Bute House drawing room. And it would have been a great relief to my voice had we got a little less time today rather than that. But that didn't turn out to be the case, probably sadly for many other reasons. But the 2 points I wanted to make by way of introduction was the first on the Cabinet Secretary's opening remarks about the importance of the private sector across tourism, investing in accessible tourism, investing in the range of services that are necessary. And on that, of course, she's absolutely right. And there are a range of ways in which that happens. But what I hope she might address in her final remarks this afternoon would be the impact of the changes to rates that has affected every tourism business across Scotland, even with the welcome reductions that have been brought in at the last minute by the Finance Secretary. Many tourism businesses that I've been made aware of have faced a 12.5% rise, and it has been capped at that. But of course, there is no, as yet, position on next year. And I hope that, as we all do, the Barclay Review this summer will produce some sterling results on that. But I would hope she'd address that point in her wind-up in relation to the impact that that has had, particularly in terms of investing in exactly the kind of services and exactly the kind of facilities that she rightly highlighted in her opening remarks. And the second point by way of introduction is Dean Lockhart's observation about the growth in tourism spend being 15% in the last year. During the course of a family visit to Castle Urquhart three or four Saturdays ago, had a long discussion with the custodian there, incidentally, where a couple were pushing, I think, their mother in a wheelchair across the Castle Urquhart slopes, which in itself was quite a demanding thing to do. It's one of the observations he made about the importance of that astonishingly beautiful part of Scotland, an astonishing castle being as accessible as it could be to people both old and with disabilities. But he did observe that there were many more tourists at Castle Urquhart. I think their numbers are considerably up in the last year, caused ironically, of course, by the weakening of the pound. Now, I'm not proposing that we get into a debate about why the pound has weakened, but there's been no two ways that that has had an impact on tourism numbers over the previous year. And the point I really wanted to address in this debate this afternoon was around what Lewis MacDonald was rightly hinting about, actually the impact of poverty on tourism and on accessible tourism. And his, I thought, very fair observation that inclusive tourism is an aspiration or a hope rather than a reality for too many families indeed. And in that sense, the reason I've tabled this amendment, I confess I was quite taken that it got selected today, but tabled this amendment today, particularly reflects the island needs in relation to how that impacts, Lewis MacDonald's point, how that impacts on people with less money and their ability to use ferry services. Now, Alistair Allen's constituency, he was here earlier on, rightly have benefited from a change in government support for some years now, and all we look for in the Northern Isles is the same arrangements that do now exist and have existed for some 7 or 8 years to the Western Isles and indeed to some of the West Coast, well, to all of the West Coast islands as well. And that's particularly the case when the cost of travel for a Shetland household, or for people visiting the islands, but certainly for a Shetland household, for a family of four, is £600 a round trip from Aberdeen up to Lerwick and from Lerwick back to Aberdeen. Now, that has a very direct impact on tourism. It has a very direct impact, particularly on tourists on potential tourists who come from families with less money, or who come from families where there is a disabled family member. Because as the DWP report from last June shows, households with a disabled family member are on average more likely to live on lower incomes, and current travel costs to and from Shetland represent therefore an additional burden for those households. So we hope the government will take that matter forward and recognise there's an equity issue there as well. The other aspect of tourism that a number of members, the front bench has already highlighted, and Lewis MacDonald made this point, particularly in relation to public conveniences, to toilets. A good example at home is at Jarlshof, which is a Bronze Age Viking remnants and very well interpreted by historic Scotland. But the need there now is for a car parking facility for buses, for cars, and for people with disabilities, because there are no public toilets at that site. Many others across the tourist industry have been making that case to Historic Scotland now, of course, whose chief executive is now, of course, Alec Patterson, used to be the chief executive of Highlands Islands Enterprise. And we hope, and if the minister could add to this, we'd be very grateful. We hope that Alec Patterson and Historic Environment Scotland will absolutely grasp the nettle of that, not least of which because the Jarlshof site is visited by many, many hundreds of tourists off cruise liners, Lerwick being one of the busier ports now in Scotland for cruise liners, with 79 ships this year, with more than 50,000 people, many of them who are more elderly, I should say, rather than rather than people with disabilities, but where they are elderly, facilities need to be appropriate for their needs, and that does not currently exist. And therefore, if the government and the cabinet secretary could put a little bit of pressure on her agency, we'd be very supportive of that indeed, because it would make just that difference to exactly the kind of tourists that she mentioned in her opening remarks, and which I entirely endorse, and the need for a change and a positive change at that. The other side I wanted to very briefly mention as well, Presiding Officer, if I may, is the Euan's Guide. Lewis McDonald and the Cabinet Secretary both mentioned that, or the government motion mentions that. Lewis McDonald made the point about it being online. Of course, that raises the somewhat obvious point that around Scotland we need a far better availability of broadband and mobile phone coverage, so that the very people who may be able to benefit from exactly the guide that is clearly so useful can. And that is not the case at this time, because broadband and mobile phone coverage for any of us who enjoy the rural and island and wild areas of Scotland know is patchy, to put it mildly. And the 4G, when I look at my phone when I was at Castlelookit the other day, 4G, there was no G on that, no G on that phone as well. The little thing was whirling as my kids all sat there trying to get onto social media and all the rest of it, which in itself was a blessing, but that in itself is by the by. The importance of broadband and mobile phone coverage has to be recognised, as that, as the lack of it has a detrimental effect both on businesses and indeed on the visitors' experience. And Euan's Guide maybe is a classic, is a graphic example of that in the context of today's debate. So I strongly welcome what has been proposed in relation to the government motion around inclusive tourism, as has been said here in Tourism Week, and hope that the government also be minded to accept our amendment, which recognises that there are some additional factors which do need to be taken forward, and they are highlighted in our amendment. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We now move to the open part of the debate. Our first speaker is David Torrance, to be followed by Jeremy Balfour. David Torrance.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We should never underestimate how attractive Scotland is as an international tourist destination, or how important tourism is for the Scottish economy. Scotland's culture, landscape and complex history attracts millions of people to visit Scotland each year from all over the world, sustaining well over 200,000 jobs. I myself have many fond memories of my own travelling around Scotland to explore and view its incredible landscapes, to visit its inspiring towns, cities and to learn about its unique and dynamic history. There should be no doubt of how attractive Scotland is for tourism, and as a country we have a responsibility to utilise this appeal to grow and sustain the Scottish economy by protecting these assets for generations to come. I welcome the news that there has been a 33% increase in the volume of visits by those in the accessible tourism market to Scotland since 2009. However, it is estimated that up to £9 billion went unspent last year in the UK because people were not aware or did not know that the particular disability would or could be catered for. As much as Scotland's tourism is heavily orientated towards outdoor activities, such as golfing, biking and hiking, it's crucial that we accept that many of our tourists, including elderly, less mobile and young children, have access needs. It is our job and our responsibility to make tourism in Scotland a more inclusively active and make it easier for our visitors to enjoy what Scotland has to offer. Visit Scotland has played a crucial role in unlocking Scotland's potential for tourism, highlighting a business initiative designed to attract more tourists, especially by making our services more accessible and inclusive. Accessibility is not much more than accommodating for wheelchairs or users. It's about the attitude of barriers that often prevent accessible policy from being pursued because of the vision of it being expensive. However, we must play our part in stimulating conversation to get access, the fact that it is the simple things that make the big differences, including getting the message across to normalise the topic. Almost half of disabled tourists spend between £500 to £1,000 on their holiday, with 10% spend around £1,500. This produces enormous social and economic barriers. We need to invest in a broader strategy that will tackle the stigma, not only for a traveller with accessible needs, but for us here in Parliament and everyone involved in the tourist industry. The business case for improving accessible tourism is strong, but more needs to be done to make it tangible to business owners who may not have incentive to improve facilities. There's been a range of initiatives to regard to accessible tourism, including Capability Scotland's Accessible Tourism Project, which aims to make Scotland the most accessible tourist destination in Europe and by identifying barriers faced by disabled people. In addition, the Guide Dogs Open for Business package, launched in 2013, offers inspiration to the tourist industry to think about ways that can make their business more inclusive. The Scottish Disability Equality Forum launched an accessible travel hub, a website that makes information, articles and guidance readily available. And last year's Aiming for Inclusive Growth event on accessible tourism was extremely successful, bringing together representatives of more than 20 tourist organisations from around Europe to raise the level of accessible tourism expertise around the continent to present policies and achievements and to share ideas and set agendas. In my own constituency, golf courses, galleries, coastal baths, museums bring hundreds of thousands of tourists to Fife every year. The massive impact that visitor expenditure has on local businesses, economy and jobs cannot be overstated. From directly influenced roles such as hotel, restaurant staff to those in transportation and retail industries, in addition to opportunities they create for services or facilities in communities that would otherwise not be sustainable. There are compelling economic as well as social benefits to ensuring that the tourism market is accessible to all. Whilst a great number of businesses in Fife and wider Scotland have already made positive changes to improve their accessibility, we must continue to develop and promote our facilities and demonstrate our commitment to accessible tourism to every visitor. The tourism industry, along with one of Fife's best known natural assets, our beautiful coastline, could be transformed by simply making our coastal areas more accessible. By promoting an inclusive and proactive approach to engage new audiences we may have felt unable to enjoy their assets previously. I believe we must do all we can so that no one feels unable to enjoy Fife's breathtaking shorelines and sceneries. In 2014, Homeland Trust Fife opened a unique accessible self-catering facility overlooking the Firth of Forth, designed and equipped to meet the needs of people with a range of disabilities and health conditions. The Paxton Drop-in Centre offers a variety of group and individual activities such as self-management courses, alternative therapies and health walks. The Fife Tourism Partnership vision is for Fife to establish a social and economic business to benefit businesses, visitors and the wider area by a whole by creating an accessible destination. The partnership also hosts a series of workshops for businesses and staff. All those services also help residents in Fife with similar disabilities, so it's a win-win scenario. Euan's Guide, an online guide to share information about places with disabled access, lists some great reviews of places in Fife, including the Harbour Master's House and Smith Theatre in Kirkcaldy. A massive number of tourist businesses and destinations are now promoting services for disabled guests as a norm, and I'm proud that Fife's tourist destinations and venues are being recommended for accessibility. In 2015, Scotland's accessibility tourism market was estimated to be worth £1.3 billion. I place extensive emphasis on stimulating conversation regarding disability and access, not just in the tourist industry, but in everyday life. Visit Scotland and tourist industry has made immense progress, but the main tourist season is approaching, and there's still much to be done to achieve the ultimate goal of making our fantastic holiday destination accessible to everyone. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I fully support the efforts of the Scottish Government and all its partners to make tourism more accessible in order to truly change lives and to support the Scottish economy.
We do have a little bit of time in hand if anyone's desperate to speak for longer than 6 minutes, and interventions would be welcome. I call Jeremy Balfour to be followed by John Mason.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'll try to keep it to 50 minutes then, in that case. Deputy Presiding Officer, it's a great pleasure to be able to take part in this debate this afternoon, and I suspect there's a lot of consensus amongst all of us as we speak. Tourism is a vital place for Scotland, and as a representative of Lothians, we benefit from so many people coming into our city all through the year. And it's good to have different types of people from different countries, from different cities, and from different backgrounds. I just wanted to touch briefly, Deputy Presiding Officer, on two or three areas in regard to how we can make tourism as accessible as possible. Before someone can benefit from arriving at a hotel or going to the castle or going to some other historical site, they've got to be able to get there. And often for people with disability, that is a major issue. We talk a lot, and rightly, about people who have issues with mobility, with wheelchair use. But we have to remember that is only 6% of people with disability. And as the Cabinet Secretary pointed out, a lot of disability can either be hidden or it can be less obvious to people. I'm pleased with what Transport Scotland has done, along with its government's encouragement into the 10-year accessible travel plan. And I hope that over these next 10 years, we will see improvements for people getting to A to B, not just for tourism, but just in life in general. I suspect one thing that perhaps we need to look at again is in regard to when people go by car to a site. Often there are disabled parking spaces available, but they are only available if you have a blue badge, which means you have a mobility issue. So you can't get a blue badge, thus can't use a disabled parking space if you don't have that. And there will be people who have contacted me who say, well, actually, I have a disability that doesn't affect my mobility, but just to get that bit closer would make it so much easier. And I do wonder whether we need to do some long-term thinking of when saying if it's a disabled parking space, it's only for those with mobility, or we need to extend it out some way that people can use it, whatever the disability. And also, I would make a plea that we should encourage those who wrongly park there, who don't have a disability, should be punished in an appropriate way. We've already heard that we need to make inclusive tourism for business, and that can happen in lots of different ways. It's training staff, it's websites, it's appropriate facilities, and I'm sure we are all aware of that, and things have improved over the last 20 years. I suspect one of the areas that we're still not good on is staff knowing when to intervene and when not to intervene. And perhaps we need to look a bit about feedback and how we do what the customer needs. Deputy Presiding Officer, I have a hidden secret. I am addicted to roller coasters. Any time I go on holiday, I try to persuade my family to go to somewhere that at least we're within knocking distance of a roller coaster. And the higher, the bigger, the faster, the better. But on a number of occasions, I've been stopped going on a roller coaster because people think my disability would stop it. Now, having explained to them about my disability and what I can do, often that is overcome. And I understand that they want to try to be appropriate. But we must always say the customer must come first, not the other way round. With pleasure.
Fiona Hyslop.
As someone who definitely doesn't do roller coasters, what I would say is I think you touched on something that's really important, and I think something that Dean Lockhart spoke about as well. It's the training, and I think also Dave Torrance talked about attitude as well, is how do we make sure that people intervene appropriately, and as you said, from a customer perspective. So a lot of this is not necessarily about expensive changes, although that will happen in some instances. Actually, as a country, if we can train our attitude, that itself is a big step forward.
Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and I absolutely agree with you. And maybe one of the ways to do this is to create ambassadors for disability. That's happening down south. There's some work being done by the UK government in appointing ambassadors who can come along and work with industry and work with tourist boards to say, well, this is what we need or this is what we don't need. And it may be well worth a bit of joined up thinking from across all four nations, where we can maybe use ambassadors to go out and speak to people about different disabilities. Because as you say, if we can educate, then often that will not cost a company or an organization any money, but can make a real benefit to the individual's experience. Can I conclude, Deputy Presiding Officer, by saying sometimes we have to recognise that a disability will stop someone doing something. And that is a hard thing to say, and it's something that perhaps we don't want to recognise. But let me just give a very practical example. If you are a wheelchair user, you are probably never going to get to the top of the Scott Monument here in Edinburgh. And that is something that we just simply have to recognise. And I think there's also an education back on disabled people to say, we will try to be as accommodating as possible, we will try to be as open as possible, we will try to educate as possible, but there are limitations that come with your disability. And so I think there are two sides of the coin, and I hope that we don't ever go to the extent that we do so much that we ruin historical buildings by making them so accessible that we lose that unique thing. And I appreciate that's a difficult balance to strike, and it's a debatable area to discuss. But I do think it needs to be said in this debate that sometimes disability does mean you can't go. Yes, we should make every opportunity possible, but not always. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Can I have John Mason to be followed by Euan Gray?
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I would like, in my speech today, to focus mainly on social tourism. I think my starting point in this debate is how much I personally, and I think a lot of others have mentioned this as well, have benefited from having a break. And that could just be a day out on the train to Mallaig. It could be a long weekend camping in the Highlands or Borders, which I assure you can be done quite cheaply with a tent, or a week away, as I did recently in Andalusia during the February recess. And actually, an interesting point I was thinking, it came to mind as Jeremy Balfour was speaking, was I was up one of these towers which the Moors built, and I think it was in Sevilla. But actually, although it's about, I don't know how many stories high, I think 13 stories, it has a ramp all the way up. And I'm not exactly sure why they did that, but it made it much more accessible than a lot of our towers. We all benefit from getting away from our usual routine and being physically in a different place. It's all very well saying I'm going to have a day off at home or a few days off, but all the usual chores kind of sit there and look at us, be it the washing or the garden or the ironing or whatever that might be. Now, clearly in Glasgow, there is a tradition where families would go away for a day or maybe a little bit longer to Millport or Rothsay or Arden or one of these beautiful islands. And I obviously do feel sorry for the residents of Edinburgh, Dundee and Aberdeen, who are unfortunate enough not to have so many islands close by them. Come and live in Glasgow. And the evidence is there from a number of studies how much individuals and families benefit from having a break. And some of the benefits that have been shown to result from such breaks includes parents having reduced stress and being better able to cope, a positive impact on mental health, families spending more quality time together, and so better family relationships going forward, and children having more confidence and increased aspirations. Other benefits are perhaps not so easy to measure, but most of us would instinctively feel that they would result. For example, families having more happy memories to share, children and families feeling more like everyone else, children and families having new experiences and broadened horizons. And I personally see breaks or holidays as a chance to reflect and get away from the treadmill, which all of us can sometimes be on. And then there are perhaps the harder benefits, but still important benefits, which have been mentioned already, of the boost for the travel and tourism industry and our resorts, especially during the low season, if more people can use them. And all of these were factors which convinced me that the Family Holiday Association, and there are other organisations in this field, like the Glasgow Children's Holiday Scheme, were doing something really worthwhile when I first came across them a number of years ago. When I met the Family Holiday Association and they were asking about an area where they could maybe get involved in Glasgow, I suggested two of the primary schools near me in Burlanarc, which is part of Greater Easter House, and we sat down with the two head teachers and discussed with them some of the possibilities, and they were immediately enthusiastic about the idea, and they could immediately come up with families who they knew would benefit from just being away, even for a day, or better still, for a long weekend. And I understand that in 2016, Visit Scotland and the Family Holiday Association arranged for some 254 families to have a short break or day out. And it is striking, and others have mentioned some of the figures, that two-thirds of these people had never had a break away together before. Now, some people would say that a holiday or a break is a luxury, and if you can't afford it, well, that's tough luck. You just can't afford it, and that's that. But I would very much want to argue against that way of thinking. Sure, none of us need a luxury holiday on a cruise ship or some incredibly expensive type of holiday. But I do believe we all need breaks from the usual routine. And that is an essential part of our lives, be that as individuals or families. Now, I do think it's the credit of this Parliament that there has been an increased focus on mental health over the last 6 years while I've been here. And surely having a break from the usual routine has got to be one of the positive ways of helping people's mental health. Now, we're told that 250,000 families in Scotland are unable to take even a short break, mainly for cost reasons.
And the numbers can be quite staggering, and I think we've got a lot to learn from other countries, as has been mentioned, France and Spain, where the unions and the tourism industry are heavily committed to the idea of social tourism. And I think Flanders is seen as one of the leaders in this sector, with some 150,000 disadvantaged people getting a break each year, as the Cabinet Secretary said, and these are quite staggering numbers. Now, Visit Scotland and the Family Holiday Association came up with this report, Tourism for Everyone, which I think looks back mainly at last year. And I have to say, it has got a number of figures in it, hard and factual figures, so I can read some of them. 254 families benefited from a short break or a day out. 90% of all families felt able to cope better after their experience. 97% visited new bits of Scotland. 94% had more confidence to try more trips in future. 88% felt more optimistic about the future. 87% said they got on better as a family. 100% would recommend attractions to family and friends. And that has to be really encouraging figures. But I think what strikes me in that report and elsewhere sometimes is the personal stories of people. We've probably all heard the stories in the past about children in Glasgow who had never seen a cow. But a few years ago, I was struck and quite shocked when I was living in London, and someone was telling me about kids in London who have never seen the Thames. And what kind of society are we in that kind of thing can still be said about us today? And some of the quotes in this report I find quite moving personally, and I hope members will be interested. For example, a family case study, Rachel and her daughter Amy live with Rachel's parents. She's a good mum and very capable, but has low self-confidence, etc. And she said, we have stayed overnight with relatives, but Amy has never left the town we live in. I mean, I just find this quite hard to even think about. Amy has never left the town we live in. I've only ever been to Edinburgh once on the train, and I really liked it. So I would like to do something like that with Amy. That's a family nowadays living in Scotland. And another one, another quote from a family. We don't have a table in our house, and dinner time is always stressful. Staying at a hotel gave us the chance to eat together at a table for the first time. And for me, that was incredible. I mean, that's pretty special, isn't it? And finally, the quote from a family who, it's not just financial issues, it's the fact that people are not used to being in hotels and things, and there can be quite a reluctance. So it says that the family needed a bit of support and reassurance in relation to staying in a hotel. Right up until the Friday of the planned weekend away, Mum was adamant that she was not going. I helped her to manage her fears and worries and build her confidence so that she felt able to go away with her boys. It has been an amazing experience for the family, and they are so grateful to everyone who made it possible. So in conclusion, I think we do see the hard side. We see the benefits of the economy, but there's real families and real people who can benefit from social tourism. Thank you.
I call Euan Gray to be followed by John Finney.
Presiding Officer, the title of this afternoon's debate is quite broad, and there's been quite a broad sweep to the debate from social tourism to disability access. I intend to use my time to focus on one particular facility in my constituency, that's Lukey House. I intend to puff Lukey House gratuitously, but I do so because I think it is a great example of what is possible, and there are some lessons there which could be learned more broadly. For those who don't know or have never seen, Lukey House is a beautiful 18th century classical mansion set in lovely grounds near North Berwick. It was for many years a respite centre for MS sufferers run from 1970 through till 1998 by Servite Nuns, and then from 1998 until 2010 taken over by the MS Society, who in 2010 made, I think, the wrong-headed decision to withdraw their support from Lukey House. And what followed was almost certain closure, halted in the end by a huge locally based campaign, but with support from all over, given that this was a national centre, a national facility. So that in 2011, Lukey House reopened, this time as an independent charity, under the redoubtable leadership of Mary O'Keefe. I have to say that Lukey House since then has received significant support both from East Lothian Council and indeed from the Scottish Government on more than one occasion. And that has allowed it to continue and indeed to expand the services it provides, because it is no longer a respite centre for MS sufferers alone, but covers a wide range of conditions. Indeed, last year, 2016, 37% of the guests were not MS sufferers, but had one of some 30 other conditions such as MND, Huntington's and others, which require very significant degrees of care. And in doing this and expanding, Lukey House has worked closely with campaigners who've been mentioned already, such as Gordon Aitman and Euan MacDonald. Now, Lukey House is a respite centre, but if you go to Lukey, they will talk to you not about respite, but about holidays, because Lukey very much sees itself as being about breaks, breaks for 4 days, maybe up to as much as 2 weeks. And why is that? Well, firstly, it's because of, happily, its circumstance to find itself in my entirely objective opinion, the most beautiful county in Scotland. The Minister talked about Scotland's beautiful countryside, visitor attractions of many different kinds, and wonderful food and drink. East Lothian has all of that and more. Lukey is a short distance from the beautiful beach in North Berwick, where North Berwick beach wheelchairs that the Minister referred to are also there. And Lukey House has a very close relationship and is a regular user, as you would imagine, of North Berwick beach wheelchairs. What's unique, I think, about Lukey is two or three things, and this is the most important. It is the model of break which Lukey provides, because Lukey is not a break or a holiday for somebody who needs significant care. It is a holiday for those who need care and their carers. Carers come with usually their loved ones to Lukey, but they do not have to carry out their day-to-day caring responsibilities. And this is the big difference. Two differences, really. This is respite for the carer without the cared-for person having to go away somewhere else. The couple, husband and wife, can stay and enjoy their holiday together. But it's not an accessible holiday which they can go to, but which means the carer has to continue with his or her caring duties day by day. So this is very much aimed at carers as well as those who are cared for. Secondly, it deals with people who have a very significant level of care. In fact, 50% of Lukey House guests last year have the very highest level of care needs. But thirdly, for a respite centre, Lukey House is just pretty good fun. The first time I visited Lukey House, I remember it was in June, and I arrived at the door to be greeted by what appeared to be Santa Claus. This was because they had realised that it was Christmas in Australia, and so they decided that it should be Christmas in Lukey as well. In recent months and years, the last year or so, Lukey staff have developed a most unusual client handling technique, which allows them to remove someone from their wheelchair, encase them in a flying suit, and then strap them into a microlight so that they can fly above East Lothian. And many are the guests who have discovered that when it comes to mobility, we are all pretty equal once we get a few hundred metres above the ground, or even perhaps in a roller coaster like Mr. Balfour. So it is very much a place which allows people the opportunities that they want, whatever they might be and whatever is required to actually provide them. It is also, though, a health facility, and the Lukey MOT has found and produced over 700 preventative interventions for its guests in the last year. They have a very intensive wheelchair examination, which has led many people to leave Lukey with a wheelchair far more suited to their needs than they arrived. And they have a close and developing relationship with Queen Margaret University in order to ensure that their care both informs and is informed by cutting-edge research in social care, which that university specialises in. So what then are the lessons of Lukey House for inclusive tourism? I think they are, firstly, that we should support Lukey House, and they have a reception here a week tomorrow, so everyone will be very welcome at 6 o'clock, the members' lounge, and you can find out more about Lukey. But the second big lesson is that in inclusive tourism, carers must be considered as well. And the third lesson is, if you believe in what is possible, Mr. Balfour may be right that you may find things that are impossible, but actually, if you really believe in what can be done, tourism can be not just inclusive, but pretty close to without limits as well.
I call John Finney to be followed by Sandra White.
Hey, thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I start by aligning myself with almost all of Mr. Gray's comments there, with the exception maybe of his constituency being the finest, and the work of Lukey House and Mr. Keefe, who I think is with us in the chamber today. I have a constituent who's probably at least one who's eternally grateful for the support that's been given there. And I think it's very good that we talk about disabilities. And I'm conscious that the term mainstreaming is used a lot, and I commend that approach. I don't think these things are about a named individual or a department. I think we are all responsible. But that doesn't mean that even new builds or new initiatives are not without their challenges. And I think it's important that technologies and procedures improve. And with that, that standards all around improve, and our expectations, because certainly there are practices, and I've heard from a number of colleagues, that hopefully in years to come we'll not hear that there are people living on one side of a city who've never been in the city centre, or people who haven't seen the countryside. And something that will underpin some of that is equalities impact assessments. And again, I'll say there's challenges remain there. These are routinely done, and sadly quite often as a tick box. So I favour a rights-based approach to how we do business, all business, and that includes tourism. And the point of reference for me in this occasion is the United Nations Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. Article 9 of the Convention requires countries to, and I quote, identify and eliminate obstacles. And there's an important role for health and safety in that, and risk assessment, and to identify and eliminate barriers. And of course, as we've heard, not all barriers are physical. Many of them are attitudinal, and particularly that's with regard to mental health. And also it goes on to say, and ensure that persons with disabilities can access their environment. And transport is terribly important. So regardless whether you're able-bodied or not, if a lift at a ferry terminal isn't working, if there are limitations with bus travel, if taxi travel proves challenging, then that will affect all of us, but it will compound itself when it comes to those with disabilities. It's also about inspection, repair and replacement regimes. And I think there's a danger that in recent years, the fabric of a lot of our communities hasn't been maintained. And public facilities and services that we all share are an important resource for tourists too. And I think there is an issue. I was speaking with the RNIB at the weekend, and there was concerns expressed about street furniture and road signage that isn't removed. So I think we need to be alert to even the very mundane things that can affect people. There's been mention made of communication technology and the benefit of that and sharing information. Again, I would align myself with the comments of Tavish Scott there. That's all very well if you're sitting with 4G in this chamber. It's not the case elsewhere. And we need greater multilingual signage. And we need to be very clear that those with hearing and visual impairments are catered for too. There's some very good news. The national collections provide free access to the public, and that allows participation for those with low income, of whom women, disabled people, and some ethnic minority groups are disproportionately represented. So I think that's very positive. And social tourism, access to breaks, most of us take for granted, is a phrase that's been said. Well, in the last session, I was part of the Equal Opportunities Committee that did a report into loneliness and isolation, and we went to the island of Islay, and my constituents, we all went to Easter House, and there are real challenges of isolation, the real challenges, and so I commend the work that, and I'm sure is taking place across the country, but NH Highland have a campaign on this just now, along with the Inverness Courier and Drakeries Primary in my own area there, where people are encouraged to mix intergenerational mixing. So there's a lot of good things happening, and I know that the Scottish Government consultation on its delivery plan 2016-2020 actually picks up on the UN rights references. And if I just pick out a few of them, Commitment 6, a new help guide aimed at boosting accessible design. I think design's everything. There are challenges, and we've heard from some people about the challenges of retrofitting, and we need to get it right from the outset. So that was connected with the legacy of the 2016 year of innovation. Another aspect, Commitment 7, was to help guide tourism industry with the importance of IT and also the social media, I think, is very important. And we also hear that Creative Scotland is undertaking a wide-ranging review of equalities, diversity, inclusion in the arts, screen and creative industries. And I hope that can be reflected in that public funding is going to the promotion of diversity in some of the arts aspects that are publicly funded. And I certainly would make public support, financial support conditional on that. Euan's guide has been mentioned by a number of people, and I think the great attraction of that is, rather than politicians pontificating, this is someone who's very much has the lived experience with their sister, and I understand Euan's from Leith and has done commendable work. And I hope it's a diminishing workload that Euan has. The Visit Scotland initiative, I think, has to be appreciated, and people have talked about some of the benefits. The concessionary bus scheme has been a tremendous boost, particularly for allowing social mobility for the older generation. And the economic benefits are very important. I have to say I'm not so drawn to the economic benefits as to the social health, both physical health and mental well-being. And I can understand that if someone's making important decisions over whether they will heat their home or put food on the table, then probably the last thing on their mind is a holiday, let alone it's anything fancier than a trip to the city centre. But we must, if we're wanting to improve our communities, we must do that, because there's no doubt that all these problems are reflected in life expectancy issues. I'm just keeping going until you tell me otherwise, Presiding Officer.
But don't take that as a given. I see maybe another half minute at the
right,
most.
Okay, okay, thanks. Well, I think Scottish Greens will support Tavish Scott's amendment tonight. I think the Northern Isles have geographic challenges. They don't mean that you shouldn't go there as tourists, but these challenges should be celebrated. Indeed, they should be supported. And when Mr. Scott refers to it as an equity issue, I would agree with that. Respitality, very, very important. The carer centres have an important role to play, both in signposting and assistance with benefits. Of course, a lot of these things are about structures, they're about facilities, they are about information. But they are also about inclusion, and I would again commend the role that access panels can play, not only in proving the lot of locals, but those visitors to the area. But fundamentally, a lot of things are about changed attitudes. I welcome the improvements. I think there's a way to go. I don't sense any complacency. I think we can have a more equitable future, and as the Cabinet Secretary said, that will take a shared endeavour. Thank you very much.
Call Sandra White to be followed by Alison Harris.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I thank John Finney. I presume that my time is absolutely dead on. I don't have extra time, perhaps, but maybe so.
You could speak a little more slowly.
I will do my best. I'm pleased to be speaking in the debate today, Presiding Officer. I think it's a debate that has been very welcome. Not just by people in the gallery and others, but by members also. I think the contributions have been excellent and in many cases very moving, in particular John Mason's contribution, very moving indeed, and I'm really pleased to be speaking on the debate. I also want to thank the many groups and individuals who have sent us in information regarding their experiences, and in particular Visit Scotland, which has been mentioned by many members actually, for the information they have sent us in regarding training programmes and access to statement tools. I think they're doing an absolutely grand job, and I thank them very much for their information. Presiding Officer, Fiona Hyslop opened up the debate and others about the great memories that they had when they were kids, and certainly we had great memories when we were kids. basically family holidays and a broth. I had written my wee speech freezing a broth, but I thought I'd score that out. I have in a broth, leaving and Port Seton, which it was called at that time, was not Seton Sands. It wasn't quite as fancy as Seton Sands is now in Port Seton. And, you know, we would never have got that break, a family from Govan, a family of eight. We would never have got a breakaway at all if it hadn't been for my father working the shipyards, a trade union and friends, being able to get a fund together. We weren't the only ones who were able to, you know, take advantage of it. Others did too, but we would never have got that break if it hadn't been that social cohesion away back even in those days. And I do thank them very much for that. Now, people have mentioned, and I mean, all things have changed, but they've not changed dramatically for lots of other people out there. It wasn't too many years ago that myself and others used to run summer play schemes, as we called them. And they're still ongoing at the moment for days out or even, you know, week holidays, as has been mentioned by John and others as well. We took these kids from Paisley, and they had never been doing the water, as you might call it. They hadn't been to Lars and Millport or Ayr, and they hadn't even been to Glasgow. We took them on subway. They'd never been on a subway before. They'd never been to Kelvin Grove. It was a fascinating experience, not just for us, but for the kids as well. And I know that these are ongoing, and it's something that we have to continue, but it's just sad, as Lewis MacDonald had mentioned as well, that in the 21st century, at this moment in time, we still have kids that need to have that as well, and kids who are still, you know, living in poverty. And there certainly has been figures provided by Visit Scotland and the Family Association, which I know that John Mason alluded to in that regard, regarding the initiatives they have done with social tourism, providing struggling families. You're in Scotland with a short break, whether it be for a day or whether it be for a week as well. And 2/3 of the families had never, never had a break together before. And I really do believe that social tourism does have the potential to help many more vulnerable families, disadvantaged families, people it's just, you know, low wage, hard time. Well, at the same time, it really does have a longer benefit in society and the economy, and not just the economy, and health as well. If you can manage to get a break, it's a fantastic thing, particularly for mental health and other health problems also. And it really does support a great need in Scotland, 250,000 families unable to take even a short break due to the circumstances that they actually live in. And when I mentioned the fact that ill health or caring responsibilities, I really think I need to mention, and others have mentioned it also, I think, and I'm trying to get this word right, hospitality with RES in the front, respitality initiative, which really has enabled 564 unpaid carers and a companion to take a break. It was given by the tourism industry at hotels, guest houses, leisure clubs and restaurants. So it's absolutely fantastic. And also the Scottish Government, which has allocated more than £20 million from 2010 to 2017 towards the Short Break Fund, administered on behalf of the carers, the National Carers Organisation by Share Scotland. You know, I think it's just fantastic. And as we mentioned before, everyone needs a break at some time in their lives. So I think that's an absolutely fantastic initiative. And we're going to talk about social tourism, you know, helping tackle deprivation, etc. I just wonder, and obviously convening the social, you know, the new social communities committee, I had been thinking before I came to this debate whether I should mention this or not, and I know that Fiona Hyslop is not the Cabinet Secretary for this, but we're looking at, you know, Child Poverty Bill, and you wonder if perhaps, and certainly I will raise this, if that should be part of the Child Poverty Bill, that we should be looking at that as part of children living in poverty, that they cannot get a break, because that does have a direct effect on how they live their lives and how their families live their lives. Now, John Mason had mentioned the fact that people hadn't even sat around a table. In some cases, these kids are living, you know, 4, 5, 6 to a room, where there's absolutely no space and no comfort to even do homework. So I just wonder within myself and within the Parliament whether we should be looking at the fact that child poverty is a terrible thing, and no one should be living in poverty. We're looking at a bill that's to eradicate poverty, that this shouldn't be part of the ethos of that Child Poverty Bill. And I'll certainly be raising that, and I would perhaps, you know, cab sector here will take it back as well and mention it perhaps even in our summing up. And somebody, presiding officer, you know, I'm glad and pleased to be speaking this debate. There's some fantastic things going on out there, and we have to move forward and ensure that not just in the social part of the deprivation, but people with disabilities also in caring responsibilities get the same chance of a break as anyone here has as well. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
I call Alison Harris to be followed by George Adam.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. We've heard from others the importance of tourism and the vital role that it plays in the Scottish economy, including the need to make it accessible to all and ideas on how to do that. We live in a country so blessed with history, beautiful scenery and modern iconic structures such as the Kelpies and the Falkirk Wheel in my hometown, that it is no wonder that we're a magnet for tourists from throughout the UK and abroad. In many shops and indeed many areas of retail, leisure and tourist attractions, there are however still far too many barriers that people with disabilities face. Last Friday, I visited the Forth Valley Sensory Centre in Falkirk and met manager Jackie Winning and a great group of people who use the centre. A number were visually impaired, others had hearing loss, but every one of them told me of the great job that the centre plays in assisting them in their daily lives and the value that they placed on the services that it provides. Deputy Presiding Officer, a 2016 survey of people with disabilities reported that only 12% of pubs and clubs were cited as good in making access easy for people with disabilities. This is not just people in wheelchairs or those with limited mobility, but people with visual impairments, deafness, and those with less obvious problems. Only 15% of restaurants, 42% of hotels, and 43% of railways, and 57% of museums and galleries were deemed to go that extra mile to make life a bit easier and enable people with disabilities to enjoy what so many people take for granted, the ability to make the most of our lovely country. Whether it's day trips, weekends away, holidays, or accessing attractions and facilities, many of our fellow citizens find that the hurdles begin right from the start. Checking out locations, travel and hotels, and in 2017, that also means the internet and websites. Often bad enough for those with good vision, but for those with limited or no sight, the challenges are tenfold. Many of Scotland's attractions, hotels and restaurants need to take into consideration the needs of those with disabilities and make their websites more user-friendly. Revamping cluttered web pages and enhancing small fonts would certainly go a long way in assisting people looking to access your business. Take, for example, Visit Scotland. Their website certainly goes a long way in making its site as accessible as possible for those with visual impairment by the simple use of good contrasts, a clear font, and an easy ability to change the background colours and the font size. Catering for people with disabilities makes good business sense. Once people find a business that knows how to make life that bit easier, has, in recent surveys, shown that these people are more likely to return to that business. Once a booking has been received, a good business can give specific help to people with a disability by giving clear and concise directions of how to get to their attraction, especially if there is the need to use public transport, highlighting any pitfalls en route. Accessibility of transport is still a major issue, as we've already heard, for many people. Not only physical access, but also the use of voice-only announcements at, take for example, airports and train stations. There is also the added difficulty of a bus driver he may face and or she may face in communicating the correct stop to get off. Within the hospitality sector, priority should be given to keeping clutter away from the entranceways and corridors. Often a simple task such as this can be of immense help to a lot of people, and perhaps the interior designers could incorporate the need to contrast colours for all people to see into the decor. Also, perhaps the larger establishments could have staff trained in British Sign Language. Happily, ever-growing numbers of older people are still able to enjoy life to the full, visiting hotels, restaurants and visitor attractions, further increasing the need for the use of such things as handrails and mid-height sockets. Deputy Presiding Officer, could I also just mention asthmatics? I do wish more hotels would remember that not everyone thinks that feather bedding or duck down implies luxury. Not offering an alternative implies a business is yet to wake up to the need of providing full accessibility of those with less obvious issues. In the design of new buildings, whether visitor centres, hotels, museums, music venues, or from cafes to transport hubs, the needs of those with sensory impairments needs to be built in from the start. Not just ramps and disabled toilets, but other aids to make the building more inclusive from the beginning. In the vicinity of major venues, local councils need to be encouraged to install specialist crossings over roads that provide not only the when to cross, but give sufficient time for people with disabilities to actually cross. Something you don't really think about when you're able to just rush across that road. I could go on, Deputy Presiding Officer, but I am delighted to have contributed to this debate and I look forward to the day when our beautiful country truly is accessible to all. Thank you.
Only 5:30. Call George Adam to be followed by Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There's a number of reasons why I'm happy to be involved in this debate, but one was reminded me by David Torrens, my colleague earlier on, when he mentioned the Scottish Disability and Equalities Forum, of which I'm declared an interest as one of their patrons. And also the fact that during just after he waxed lyrical about the coastline of Fife, he says, and what has it Paisley's got to offer people, which could have, Presiding Officer, changed the tone of this speech. But I'll just refer him to the official record and previous debates that we've had. But I'm obviously pleased to be part of this debate for a number of reasons. The main one being that, obviously, I'm a man who's married to a woman that has a disability, and the disabling condition has changed over the years that we have been married. And I'm often kind of, I know what it's like when it's when you're arranging a holiday or when you're trying to go abroad. The silly wee things that everyone takes for granted are the things that we automatically have to, well, I say we, it's the royal we, Stacey has to organise, because I tend to believe there is no such thing as a problem that we can't overcome, but Stacey likes to make sure that there's just a wee bit of reality in that statement as well, and make sure that we do, because you have to make sure that you understand that where you go, there is accessibility for you to get backwards and forwards, you can enjoy it, and both, if in a husband and wife situation, both can actually enjoy that as well. And I'm often think about the fact that when we first went abroad, when Stacey's disability got worse, was we went to Rome for a weekend. Now, Presiding Officer, Rome's been there for a wee while, and it's not the most accessible place in the world, but we never missed anything. We managed to get ourselves from A to B and managed to see everything. And there was one point when Stacey actually said, you know, I never thought as my disability got worse, that I'd be able to be going down the side streets and all that. I personally take all the credit for that, but at the end of the day, there was actually, that's how someone feels in that scenario. And I think if we're having this debate and we're talking about how things can be so much better, then it shows the kind of future we're looking for. And I also come at this, and I think it was John Finney mentioned, access panels. I was a member of, and still am a member of, Renfrewshire Access Panel. And they used to complain and moan on a regular basis when I first met them, because they felt as if they weren't being listened to and they weren't involved in the process. And there was a whole list of things locally that they worried about. But since then, we've managed to get them involved and engaging with the local authority. And an example of that would be Paisley's historic town hall, which has now had a £1.7 million revamp. And part of that was to ensure that we could get access to the front of the building. Instead of going in some side entrance and some side door to event, you were actually going in with everybody else. And that sends out an important message to everyone that they are equally as important as a customer, a client, or a person attending an event. And that was from the design stage. They were involved. They were involved to make sure that it didn't make any difference to the historic building. It still looks the same. It still is the same impressive building, but it was designed that wee bit different to make sure that we could actually bring it into the 21st century and get that access there as well. So I think when you look at some of the things that have been done locally, I can actually see that an access panel is extremely important with that. And I think one of the things we also want to talk about is it's only sensible that people visit destinations that they offer them the actual support. And it's not always about physical access, as others have said here today, because my personal circumstances are about accessibility with Stacey. But we already said, as Fiona Hyslop has already, the Cabinet Secretary said, 71% of people with disabilities are non-visible. And it's important that any accessible tourism approach must take this into account, designed in such a manner that it fully is and fully inclusive and meets the needs of all potential groups. And that means absolutely everybody. At this point, I would like to talk about Euan's Guide, as everyone else has, because although it's not always about accessibility, in many cases and for many people, that is one of the main issues. And Euan's Guide was founded in 2013 by Euan MacDonald and his sister Kiki, and one of the things that they made sure was it's almost like a simple night out with someone with a disability and a family can be like Normandy D-Day type landing organisation to know where is the toilet. Can we move about in the venue? Can you get into the venue? Once you're in the venue, are you able to move about as well? And these are all things that normally people take for granted. And it's good to see that we're actually looking at this as a way forward, because I think, as Alison Harrison quite rightly said, if you design that in such a way, then people will come back. They'll automatically come back. Their family members will come back. So it will help the economy, and it will help that tourist destination as well. And I think it's important. Some things were mentioned about training as well, and I think that's extremely important as well. But Euan's Guide listings also gives you information about accessible toilet, wheelchair access, hearing loops, and multiple other access information. And I know that Euan is also a keen football fan. And there's also a situation in Scotland when we're talking about access and tourism and part of the economy is our national sport. You know, it depends on which stadium you turn up at, whether it's what kind of experience you're going to get on that given day. And I was part of the recent successful fan buyout of St Mirren, along with Gordon Scott. And one of the first things that we did in Paisley 2021 Stadium was that we ensured that we had a disabled platform that was at a level that people could actually see and be protected from the elements. Now, that sounds a simple thing to do, but in a lot of football grounds, that I'm looking at Mr. Finney Hearts, is actually not too bad as well. They have quite a good accessible area as well. But there's many grounds where you're just left at the front and to the elements and get absolutely soaked as well. And I think if we're going to... You know, one of the things that if we're going to remember this, all our businesses, whether it be football clubs, whether it be others, they have to think about who their patrons are potentially going to be and how inclusive they are going to be with that as well. And I think that shows that whereas the club before just had you down at the bottom, now we've got this platform that's probably one of the best in Scotland. But the situation we had before was during the Commonwealth Games, we actually had to fight to keep the temporary disabled platforms in the stand, the north stand in Hampden Park. And that just shows you, you know, and even in this day and age, we still have to have these debates and fights. So I think this is an absolute fantastic debate for us. I think it's great that we're all, and Visit Scotland are taking it serious about the fact that there is a market there for people with disabilities and families there. And I think we need to work at that, we need to grasp this, because we've got this opportunity here to show that Scotland is that country that will go out that extra mile to make sure that regardless of your background and regardless of your abilities, you will still be able to get access to a decent holiday or a venue.
Thank you.
I call Rhoda Grant to be followed by Richard Lyle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Tourism makes an important contribution to the Scottish economy, and if we want to protect that, we need to have world-leading facilities. Other countries recognise the benefit of their tourism industry and look to constantly upgrade the facilities they have to meet customer needs. I like getting out and about and seeing different parts of Scotland and have no problems recommending it to domestic and foreign tourists. However, getting around some of our most beautiful parts proves challenging for disabled people. Someone who has mobility problems depends on a wheelchair can find it challenging because that thought hasn't been put into the way we design our tourist attractions. However, it's not just about wheelchair users. We need facilities to take account of different types of disabilities. People who have limited vision need colour contrast to find their way around facilities. How often are disabled toilets and bathrooms all white? The porcelain, the walls, the floor, even the grip handles and shower curtains are all white, and worst of all, the toilet seat. It might be accessible to someone with sight, but it isn't accessible to someone with impaired vision. The same is true of audible fire alarms in hotels, not very reassuring if you're profoundly deaf. The use of written signs does not work for people with cognitive impairment, and the list goes on and on. When designing visitor attractions, such basic design ideals should be incorporated. What makes somewhere accessible to people with disabilities also makes it accessible for everybody. Easily understandable information alongside physical accessibility creates no barriers but allows everyone to enjoy our wonderful facilities. Euan and Kiki MacDonald set up Euan's Guide, which many people have mentioned today, a trip advisor for people with disabilities. And I'm really proud that Ryan McMullen, who helped pioneer the Inclusion Scotland internship programme in the Parliament, now works with them too. Euan's Guide is a really useful tool. Imagine your frustration if you decide to go out with family or friends and discover you can't access the venue that they have booked. Euan's Guide gives people confidence to plan a trip, a meal, or simply a drink out with friends. It was good to see Euan, Kiki and Ryan in the Parliament last week encouraging MSPs to feed in reviews on accessibility to make it easy for people to plan social events. Another advocate for accessibility is Mark Cooper, who headed up the BARD campaign fighting for legislation to promote accessibility. And as others have said, this is now in statute and has been for many years, but is yet to be enacted. It's a simple piece of legislation that forces licensees to think about how accessible their premises are for disabled people. The people who have driven the greatest change often have a disability, and it's often said that necessity is the mother of invention, but actually all they're asking for is fairness and equality, the ability to enjoy what the rest of us take for granted. Gordon Aikman has been mentioned in his work bringing practical initiatives to the attention of those in power. And his writing was also really powerful. And one piece that especially struck a chord with me was when he was able to get onto the beach with a specially adapted wheelchair. The sheer pleasure of being able to do something that we all enjoy and take for granted. I also want to talk about public transport too, as people also need to be able to travel to venues and attractions. Imagine how it feels if the bus simply drives past because they see you are in a wheelchair and they cannot be bothered to spend the time to lower the ramp. I know of someone having a day out who was left behind by the last bus some 30 miles from home because the ramp didn't work. This would put paid to anyone's confidence, and would they risk going out again? We've all read about the high-profile cases where wheelchair users have been left behind because of bikes and buggies taking up the disabled spaces on buses. We need to provide space for bikes and buggies, but people in wheelchairs are especially vulnerable, and therefore they must have priority. People who have vision impairment have difficulty using buses as well because there's no audible announcements. People who can see can tell where they are, and there are often signs they can read on buses saying where the next stop is. However, if you can't see, you have to depend on the driver to tell you. And train travel can be just as bad. There are only a couple of wheelchair accessible spaces, and you need to buy a ticket and then book your wheelchair space. You can't just turn up because someone needs to be there to help you fit a ramp to get onto the train. And even if you book a wheelchair space, there's no guarantee that you'll get on the train, because if somebody else in a wheelchair is there before you, you can't get on because there are limited spaces. And I know of people who have booked correctly and still experience problems. And it's easy to see how your confidence can disappear and people become isolated because of lack of access to transport. The Liberal Democrat amendment takes this further by asking for affordable ferry fares for all, noting that disabled people are more likely to face poverty. That's correct, but they're also more likely to have to travel with an assistant or a family member due to the barriers that they will face. Presiding officer, people with disabilities need to enjoy the same freedoms as the rest of us take for granted. So when you're out and about, assess your journey an experience from the point of view of a disabled person. If you see something that's worked well, then put a review on Euan's Guide and tell others so that they can use your experience. Euan's Guide don't have enough reviews from the Highlands and Islands, so they were telling me last week. So that's my mission, to get people to review facilities in this beautiful region. And it's not just about holidays and social interaction. The same principles are required for day-to-day life and access to work.
Thank you very much. I call Richard Lyle to be followed by Bill Bowman. Mr. Lyle, please.
Thank you, President Officer. I'm delighted to be contributing to the Scottish Government debate on inclusive tourism, particularly as a constituency MSP for Uddingston and Belsill, which is home to so many amazing visitor attractions, many of which I hope to highlight in this debate, not only for their many interesting features, but for their inclusive and accessible credentials. Before I come to the many wonders of Lanarkshire, I wish to focus on specifically the issues around access to attractions and places of interest in Scotland. Presiding Officer, it has to be said that improving the accessibility of tourism products and services has a real potential to enhance social equality, help achieve industrial growth ambitions, and boost the wider economy. Therefore, inclusive tourism supports the continual strategic economic focus on the four I's of innovation, investment, internationalisation, and inclusive growth within Scotland's economic strategy. A strategy which has been deployed by Visit Scotland through the Inclusive Tourism Programme, which involves delivering on their accessible tourism approach with an aim to harness the growing inclusive tourism market and help make Scotland an international recognised inclusive destination with a resultant increase in economic, cultural and social benefits. While I'm keen to highlight the inclusive credential of some of many of my local attractions and places of interest, I do also wish to share a few of the core messages from a report which was emailed to me by Equality Network entitled Wish You Were Here, the Scottish LGBT Travel Report, and indeed some examples of Visit Scotland's ongoing work. Wish You Were Here by the Equality Network highlights key research findings relating to LGBT travel and perceptions of Scotland as an LGBT-friendly destination. In the report, which had 1,365 total responses, of which 930 were criteria fulfilled, it outlined that 77% of people consider Scotland an LGBT-friendly destination. Clearly from the report, feeling welcome is very important to LGBT travellers, and whilst the perception is that Scotland is an LGBT-friendly destination, it's quite high among Scottish LGBT travellers. There is a need for improvement among individuals. I hope that this is an area which, across the Chamber, we can work together to ensure that we do more work as part of our wider consideration on inclusive tourism. Moving on, Presiding Officer, I'm delighted that Visit Scotland has been working with and encouraging business owners and industrial partners to engage with accessible tourism programmes for a number of years now, helping position Scotland as an inclusive and accessible destination. I recall this being recognised in September 2016 when Visit Scotland co-organised with partners at Visit Flanders a conference on behalf of the European Network for Accessible Tourism, ENAT. The conference, which the Cabinet Secretary addressed, focused on best practice in delivering and marketing accessible tourism. More locally, however, I'm aware that Visit Scotland have been working closely, as many people have said already, Euan's Guide over the last few years, including commissioning the organisation to develop a series of accessible itineraries of things to do and see in Glasgow, and a place close to my heart and in my constituency, the fantastic Strathclyde Park. I'm sure we all can agree in joining Visit Scotland in its view that Euan's Guide are important partners in advocating Scotland's inclusive tourism programme for businesses and continue to support them with their disabled access activities. On Strathclyde Park, the Chair of Lanarkshire Area Tourism Partnership, Mark Calpin, said, Lanarkshire offers a variety of accessible attractions and accommodation, including M&D's, Scotland Theme Park, the Boathouse Gym, the Alona, the Holiday Express Inn within Strathclyde Country Park. The partnership is committed to welcoming all visitors by improving customer service and information for anyone with access additional access needs. And that's exactly what we should be championing today. And I was listening intently to a speech by George Adam when I was researching, considering what contributions to make during today's debate. I checked out Euan's guide online and was pleased to see that Strathclyde Park has received a review from a user of the park who eloquently puts across the benefits of this space in my constituency. The individual said, there is a multitude of nice areas around the park and the lake. There's a step-free path that goes around the whole of the lake. It's a good place to visit for a change of scene and for some fresh air, and lots of activities to keep you active. Of course, Strathclyde Park isn't the only amazing attraction in my constituency. I'm very lucky to have attractions such as Bothwell Castle, which is an historic venue and a beautiful part of my constituency. I also have the fantastic Hamilton Racecourse, where many excellent race meetings are held along with various functions. However, I recognise that sometimes these amazing spaces and places can be costly to access. And access restricted by cost is an area which I want to end my remarks on today. As already has been said by, I believe, Sandra White, there are still many families across, and John Mason, there are many families across Scotland who don't have the opportunity for a break due to a low income or struggling situations. We believe, and I believe, that everyone should have an opportunity for a break. The impact for those who do not have that opportunity for a break is huge, and helping increase access to tourism holds great potential. In 2016, Visit Scotland, in partnership with the Family Holiday Association and over 30 partners from across the tourism industry, delivered two successful social tourism initiatives, which provided 254 struggling families in Scotland with a short break. Initiatives like these truly showcase the best of inclusive tourism, where we lend a hand to those who need it, and well-deserved break can mean a difference. As we move forward as a country, I want us to continue to make accessible tourism a priority, so that regardless of what you have as an accessible requirement, or whether you are LGBT or face financial difficult times, that we all need that break and spaces to escape to. Scotland is a country filled to the brim with potential, not only in tourism, but in the most general of senses. I look forward to us continuing to unlock that potential, and I once again welcome today's debate. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lyle. I call Bill Bowman to follow by Gordon MacDonald, and Mr. MacDonald be the last speaker in the open debate. Mr. Bowman, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'd like to thank Fiona Hyslop for taking me on a short trip down memory lane with her earlier on. I remember as a kid seeing these taxis in Glasgow with the balloons and the streamers taking children to the seaside for a charitable short break. And also thanks to Sandra White for reminding me about the trips from the Broomalaw down the river to the tail of the bank. These are things which had slightly got lost in the clouds of my memory. Today's debate gives everyone taking part an opportunity to speak about and highlight some of the reasons why we love Scotland and why so many people come and visit our natural beauty, our illustrious history, our many scenic routes, and the fantastic range of attractions and sites for young and old alike. And all of that before mentioning Scotland's fabulous food and drink. As today's debate has highlighted, tourism is one of Scotland's key economic contributors, and with visitor expenditure totalling over $5 billion in 2015, and it is Scotland's largest industry. I will speak a little bit now about my area of the northeast region, and I suspect it will not be in such eloquent and lovely terms as the time for reflection minister did about Murray. In 2015, almost 400,000 people visited the Dundee Contemporary Arts Centre, and over 140,000 visited the McManus Art Gallery and Museum. These are two impressive attractions in the centre of the city, one that is a world-class centre for the development and exhibition of contemporary art and culture, the other a museum that charts Dundee's rich industrial history as a city once famous for jute, jam and journalism. I do, of course, encourage members to visit this chamber, to visit them both when they get the opportunity. And Dundee's tourism industry is set to get an even bigger boost in the next few years with the opening of the V&A Museum and the redevelopment of the waterfront. And I think our hope is, and I hope it will be more than a hope, that the V&A will be designed to be accessible to all. These two projects are a sign of a city that very much wants to be open for business and are ones that will have a very positive impact on the city by encouraging inward investment and should lead to the creation of new jobs, many of them tourist-related. In 2015, the tourism industry supported over 9,000 jobs over the Dundee and Angus area. Figures like this demonstrate just how important the industry is, not only to our overall economic performance, but also to our local economies, the length and breadth of Scotland, particularly our rural communities, where many small businesses depend on tourism in order to survive. Presiding Officer, Scotland's tourism success is one that we can all share in, but this afternoon's focus is on how we involve everyone in our tourism industry and open it up to those who may feel they have not yet discovered Scotland for whatever reasons, as we have heard earlier. Towards the end of last year, out with the peak tourist season, Visit Scotland piloted the scheme that they hoped would put social tourism on the map. In partnership with Family Holiday Association, as well as accommodation, transport and activity providers, they provided over 250 struggling families with at least one child who had not had a break for a long time with exactly that, a family break. I suspect that most of us in the chamber could take the idea of a family break for granted. But according to Visit Scotland, one in three people in Scotland are unable to take a holiday due to cost, ill health, or caring responsibilities. In true Scottish fashion, the marketing of this scheme was centred around Spirit of Scotland, or hashtag ScotSpirit, a campaign at its heart designed to give families the opportunity to get away and spend quality time together. At the start of my contribution, I spoke about Dundee, a city where one in four children are recognised as living in poverty, and a city that has the third largest percentage of its population living in the 15% most deprived areas. Now, this is not a record for us to be proud of. Behind these figures are a lot of families who will not have been on holiday together, who will not have travelled and experienced most of the country they live in, but families who I hope will benefit from Visit Scotland's ambition to make sure that everyone is able to experience our tourism industry for themselves. I have to confess that before today's debate, I was not wholly familiar with the concept of social tourism. I've certainly learned a lot, I must admit, from listening to others. And perhaps it's no great surprise that because, unlike in several countries in Europe where it receives public funding, it is a less well-known idea concept in Britain. But as Visit Scotland's pilot demonstrated and has been spoken about today, there are a number of benefits to be reaped from exploring it more. Benefits for young people and their self-developments, benefits for their families, and benefits for our economy. To conclude, social tourism is about opening up opportunities for individuals and families. While it is important to go out and promote Scotland to the world, we cannot and must not forget about our own people here at home, in particular those who need support, to enjoy what some take for granted. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bowman. I call Gordon MacDonald, then move to closing speeches after that. Mr. MacDonald, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Purple Pound is recognition of the spending power of disabled people and their families. And in relation to tourism, this was estimated to be worth $1.3 billion to Scotland's economy in 2015. The Visit Scotland briefing highlights that one of their key priorities is accessible tourism. And you can understand why when you realise there are 12 million disabled people in the UK alone whose spending power is estimated to be worth over $200 billion a year. I was recently contacted by a constituent who has a 16-year-old disabled son, and she highlighted a major issue that impacts on residents and tourists alike, and that is a lack of changing places toilets. In Scotland, there are just 144 changing places toilets, including one here in the Scottish Parliament, but not one at Edinburgh Airport, Scotland's biggest airport, although they are planning to have one installed next year. The difficulties that lack of facilities presents were highlighted by my constituent. She quotes, a significant number of people and their family carers are unable to access services or visit places because of a lack of adequate toilet facilities. Changing places toilets enable many people with profound and multiple learning disabilities to participate in the community. But sadly, there is currently no legal requirements for provisions of these fully accessible toilets, therefore excluding many people with PMLD from leading as normal a life as possible and hugely affecting their quality of life. Over 230,000 people in the UK require changing places toilets, including those with profound and multiple learning disabilities, people with conditions that may affect their movement, including cerebral palsy and motor neuron disease, people with head or spinal injuries, people living with a stroke, or older people who require assistance. PAMIS, the Dundee-based charity promoting a more inclusive society, is part of the campaigning group Changing Places that seeks an improvement in the provision of CP toilets. They highlighted that some of the difficulties where people with complex disabilities require assistance from one or two assistants. Without a suitable changing bench, many disabled people have to be laid on the floor to be changed. This is undignified, unhygienic, and puts assistants at risk of injury. In the absence of a hoist, assistants are again put at risk when forced to manually transfer a disabled person who is unable to self-transfer between a wheelchair and the WC. My constituent in our meeting informed me that the lack of adequate toilet facilities leave many people isolated, lonely, and frustrated. We can't stray too far from somewhere we can change him. On days when the weather keeps us indoors, my son becomes so bored, lonely, and frustrated, he will repeatedly knock the same spot in the wall until his knuckles are grazed and he wears the wallpaper and crumbles holes in the wall. The Equality Act 2010 protects disabled people against direct discrimination and indirect discrimination and requires that owners of public and commercial buildings take reasonable steps to make sure that their premises and services are accessible. The public sector equality duty requires that public bodies place equality at the heart of everything they do. The Scottish Government's strategy, The Keys to Life, Improving Quality of Life for People with Learning Disabilities, was published by the Minister for Public Health in June 2013. The document sets out a vision for improved partnership, working to deliver better outcomes for people with learning disabilities and their families and carers. The strategy outlines some of the risks and inequality experienced by people with profound and multiple learning disabilities of being unable to use the toilet facilities when out on a day trip. Yet the non-domestic building technical handbook that provides advice to architects and engineers makes it clear that the provision of changing places toilets is at the discretion of the property owner and is not a requirement. 7 years after the Equality Act and 4 years after the Scottish Government strategy, we need a change to the law to ensure these facilities are provided and improve the quality of life for disabled people. This will encourage more people with disabilities and their families to visit Scotland, and in particular our capital city, Edinburgh, creating jobs and growing our economy. Many countries across Europe have recognised the spending power of disabled people, and the European Commission, along with the European Disability Forum, organises the Access City Awards that are now in their seventh year. The awards recognise those cities that are examples of best practice in making EU cities more accessible. Chester is the winner of the 2017 competition, the first UK city to win the award, and was chosen out of 43 cities from 21 countries. What an accolade for Scotland's capital if we could aim to win this award in future years. The publicity that would be generated would not only encourage many of the 12 million disabled people in the UK to visit, but it will also encourage the 80 million EU citizens who are disabled to consider Edinburgh and Scotland as a world-class holiday destination. If we are serious about accessible tourism, then we have to address the issues affecting disabled residents and tourists alike. Edinburgh Airport has recognised the need to address this issue, and I would urge other tourist-related attractions to consider how they can support disabled visitors to enjoy a day out in Edinburgh and across Scotland.
Thank you very much, Mr MacDonald. Now call on Tavish Scott to close for Liberal Democrats. 7 minutes or thereabouts, Mr Scott.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Well, Gordon MacDonald, having raised Edinburgh Airport, I can't resist a couple of observations about that. And if he's making representations to them, let me give him another couple of examples. Because all the gates along at the far end of the pier from about 11 onwards don't all have lift access. So Mr MacDonald made a very strong argument there about particular facilities needed at Edinburgh Airport, the capital city's entrance into Scotland for lots and lots of people coming on flights from all over the UK and all over the world. And yet, if you are a mum with a pushchair, or if you are a person with a disability, or if you're old and struggle with steps, there are too many of those gates at Edinburgh where there is no lift. And I believe Mr MacDonald is right to highlight, as indeed others have done, the importance of airports that are money-making ventures. After all, they have to be profitable to survive, investing in the kind of facilities that are needed. Because Rhoda Grant was right in her earlier remarks. These are not just facilities that help people when they're going on holiday or help people when they are taking a short break, as other members have highlighted, but they are about people going about a normal day. And Mr. MacDonald's quite right to highlight that. He also raised a financial number, a figure about how much inclusive and accessible tourism is worth to Scotland. A number of those have been correctly banded around this afternoon. But it was the two human speeches of this debate, if I may put it that way, that really struck me this afternoon. The first was George Adams. I'm still slightly contemplating the vision of George and Stacey Adams on the on the floor of the Colosseum in Rome. I don't know who'd be more frightened, the lions or George Adams. Well, I think I do know who'd be more frightened, presiding officer. But he, George Adam, made a very strong point about the design stage involvement, access panels and other ways in which people who have an inherent and deep knowledge of how facilities should be designed should be involved in public buildings and in other buildings that are being constructed or are being adapted to make them more accessible for wheelchair access or for people who need other assistance. And that, I believe, is a very strong case indeed. He made a point about, I was about to say Love Street, but I'm too old for, when I started watching Premiership football, it was Love Street, but no longer, about the design of modern stadia. Certainly, ironically, being at Anfield on Saturday, the wheelchair, folk in wheelchairs were down the front of that main stand, and George Adam made a good point that if it's pouring with rain, they're the folk who are going to get the wettest in the climatic conditions. So that is something for stadia to stadium designers to take into account, and obviously that is being thought of. The second was Jeremy Balfour, who made a very thoughtful series of remarks about the importance of facilities being appropriate for use. He made some observations about disabled parking spaces for people with limited mobility, not just those with blue badges. I think he shared the thought to the Chamber this afternoon that the policing of that or the definition of that would create some interesting challenges for local councils and for legislators. But nevertheless, there is an important principle to at least consider there, and as well the ongoing issue of the abuse of spaces by people who just shouldn't be there in the first place. But he also, I thought, importantly said there needs to be a sense of realism in this discussion, because there are limitations, there will be limitations. My part of the world is the Noss Nature Reserve and indeed the Herman S. Nature Reserve. They are not the easiest places to get to, and it is beyond SNH or indeed any of our other agencies to put in place perfect accessible access to nature reserves, which involve a 5-minute ferry crossing in an inflatable boat and then a walk around the cliffs. So we need to find other ways so that people can experience and enjoy the absolute extraordinary wildlife and bird life of parts of Scotland such as that. But Jeremy Balfour made a strong point about the need to recognise occasionally we cannot just do everything that we may wish to do. He also finished by saying he made a great couple of lines about being on a roller coaster. coaster and enjoying being on a roller coaster. Well, Jeremy Olling says you're on one now. It's going to last about a couple of years, and goodness knows what's going to happen at the end of it. But that's certainly for a different debate altogether. Just two final points, if I may, Deputy Presiding Officer. Rhoda Grant made, I think, an important point about facilities being there for not just visitors and tourists with disabilities or with particular needs, but about everyday life. And she rightly made the point about ferry services and the cost of those ferry services. They're not, of course, just for people, much as all people will benefit from that. The point I wanted to make here is that James Tate from the Shetland Tourism Association pointed out last year that 78% of local businesses in Shetland describe expensive travel costs as the main disincentive to visitor tourism and barrier to industry growth. And that is my observation to the government in designing, in this case, transport policies that are supportive of the growing tourism industry in Scotland, that they do need to take into account the wider benefits that would have to residents and to visitors, as well as to specifically in the context of this debate, inclusive and accessible tourism as well. Could I finally conclude by supporting the amendments both in Lewis MacDonald's name and in Dean Lockhart's name as contributions to the government's motion, which we will support from these benches as in the tone of this debate. This is very much a matter, I suspect, for broad parliamentary agreement.
Thank you very much. Mr Scott called Monica Lennon to close for Labour. 7 minutes or thereabouts, please, Ms Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I too welcome the chance to take part in the debate today. We also have welcomed the government motion and all of the opposition amendments today. And we also appreciate support for our amendment from members who have confirmed that so far. We firmly believe that everyone should be able to equally enjoy access to the many wonderful places and visitor attractions right across Scotland. And we've heard about many of those places today. I think sometimes, well, we've heard today about roller coasters. Sometimes politics feels like a roller coaster ride, but it's been nice today to actually look at our common appreciation of the places, not only in our own regions and constituencies, but also the places that we've visited as perhaps in our younger days or with our families. So I think it's been nice today to look at our common appreciation and love for our own little parts of Scotland. But as the Cabinet Secretary said, not everyone yet has that same equity of access. And it is unfortunate that there's a number of things that we still have to do to make sure that everyone can enjoy the quality of access. I was very heartened by the Cabinet Secretary's opening remarks and that she is firmly committed to that. And I think that's a determination that we can see across the Chamber. So I think it is very much a debate about Scotland's wonderful places, but it is a debate about equality today, about our connections with our people and with place. And as many colleagues have mentioned across the Chamber, it's about health and it's about well-being and just about kind of being nice to yourself and being kind to each other in doing so. So I think I've learned a lot about other parts of Scotland and appreciated other people's lived experience, and hopefully that's something we can all reflect on today. There's been a number of very real challenges raised, so I think it does bring a dose of reality to the debate. In terms of some of the physical barriers, we've talked about the historic environment, and it's always that conundrum about the places that we love because they come from another point in history, but if you start to completely change them, then they lose that value. But I think given the creative minds and talents we have in Scotland, it's not beyond us to find solutions. And I think John Finney was absolutely right to talk about new buildings and about the constant changes that we face in terms of not just the fabric of buildings, but also transport, as other colleagues have mentioned, about lighting, about street furniture, and the maintenance of those things. I know when I'm in Hamilton Town Centre, I get really annoyed about the A-boards, which I know that traders love because everyone wants to showcase their business and do it in different ways. And sometimes you can't fix it onto the shop front because that perhaps might be a listed building. But that kind of clutter in the street becomes a real barrier to people who are trying to get around. I think David Torrin said a really nice thing when he said it's the simple things that can make the biggest difference. And I know other people have echoed that today. And I think that's true. And I know that John Finney also talked about the importance of equality impact statements. We've talked about the work of access panels. So it's great to see that there's a high level of awareness across the chamber about the importance of these things. Alison Harris, who I bumped into this morning, and she was telling me about her visit to Forth Valley Sensory Centre. And again, it's good that she's brought that into the debate today. And I think Rhoda Grant also made some really good points, and particularly in relation to toilets, which have been talked a lot about today, which are important, but also about public transport and the need for audible announcements. And I think we can all agree there's work to be done there. In terms of our debate today, Labour's amendment to the debate today, again, we've put on record our thanks to Mark Cooper, a campaigner, and it is due to Mark's hard work and determination that he helped secure change to the Criminal Justice and Licensing Act 2010. And we do look forward to the implementation of that legislation, and I did note that the Cabinet Secretary was nodding in a friendly manner to Lewis MacDonald at the beginning, so we hope to hear something about that perhaps in closing. I know that Dean Lockhart said that you know, if the sector can lead in terms of changes, then that is sort of better than regulation. But I think when you see, even when there is regulation, it still has to be implemented and indeed enforced. So I think again, that's another area where we need to see some improvement. I think if we all fall off the roller coaster that is Scottish politics, perhaps there could be a future career for some of us in terms of tourism and marketing. We've heard some wonderful tributes to special places in people's areas. Ian Gray, I think, gave a very moving and impressive speech earlier on about Lucky House, and I thought it was just a wonderful image to think of someone soaring over East Lothian in a micro light. So we've had roller coasters, we've had micro lights, and I think it is important that whilst we're looking at some of the very practical challenges that are faced, that we don't set any limits on our aspiration when it comes to making Scotland an equal country. Dean Lockhart also mentioned access to national parks, which is really important, and he talked about all-terrain vehicles in the Trossachs. So again, there's lots of good work to touch on. But in terms of the issues around poverty and the need for more socially inclusive approaches, I think we've had some really sort of powerful statements on that today. I think John Mason's comment about the child in London who'd never seen the Thames, I think that's something that we can probably all relate to in terms of our own constituents and people that we know. And I think Sandra White, I don't know if she was just thinking out loud, but when she said perhaps we need to explore through the Child Poverty Bill, I think that was quite encouraging. I was thinking during the debate about school trips, you know, quite often for young people it's where you go with your classmates and with your school, and it could be a very local trip to your, you know, your local museum, but it could be a residential trip. And for some families, it really is beyond their reach. And I know that when everyone comes back after school holidays, people want to know, where did you go? And sometimes we need to think about, you know, the sort of pressure that puts on young people as well. So I think there's much that we can all agree on in the speeches today. As I say, we would appreciate support for our amendment. We think it is an important one. And I know there was extra time going around, but I don't know if that's gone, Presiding Officer. So, do I have much time left? Or?
You can have another minute if you like, as long as you speak into your microphone, because you had a wee bit of an issue about turning away from it.
Okay, right, I'll try.
Can you just confirm for me one thing? Was Ian Gray in the micro light? I didn't hear that bit.
That's in the next chapter, with Jeremy Balfour, but And I mean, Richard Lyle also spoke, you know, Richard and I are in neighbouring parts of Lanarkshire, of course.
Just as a point of information.
Sorry, Ian Gray.
Yes, as a point of information, I have been challenged by Lucky House to micro light fly to raise money, so I look forward to the donation from the Deputy Presiding Officer.
Well, you've caught me well out there, yes, I agree.
Well, perhaps you can microfly your way over to Strathclyde Park, where you might get a warm welcome from Richard Lyle, and would be And Jeremy Balfour would be very welcome to come to M&D's theme park as well and try out the roller coasters there. So I think we can all agree there's lots to offer. I was also pleased that Richard had mentioned the submission from the Equality Network. So we've talked a lot about disability, we've talked about poverty, but I think it is important to recognise LGBTI issues as well. And it is encouraging that 77% of people said that they see Scotland as an LGBTI-friendly destination. But again, there's more we can do to build on our reputation there. So thank you for your generosity, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And it'll teach me to intervene from the chair. Call Rachel Hamilton, please. 9 minutes or thereabouts, Ms Hamilton.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I draw members to my register of interests. And members will know I own a hospitality business. Today we've heard excellent contributions from all sides about the benefits that tourism can bring to the Scottish economy and how rightly this sector should be proud of what it has achieved. I'm sorry I won't be able to mention everybody's wonderful ideas and thoughts in closing today, but I thought there were some very, very excellent contributions. I just want to make the same point as Tavish Scott about George and Stacey Adam. I find it amazing that you visited Rome, George, because I actually visited Rome and went to the Forum, the Colosseum and the Spanish Steps, and I found it quite a challenge myself with my family. But Fiona Hyslop reminds us that there are many reasons why visitors come to Scotland. We have wonderful food and drink, and we have exceptional landscapes as well. But we know it's not just about physical access, but accessible tourism opens the doors to those with visual impairments, hearing impairments, learning disabilities, and for those with mental health. A number of members have mentioned today the value of the tourism industry and spending by Tourism Scotland, as we know, generates 12 million in economic activity in the wider Scottish supply chain and contributes 6 billion to the Scottish GDP. As we celebrate Tourism Week, I'd like to pay tribute to those who work really hard to drive the economy and create jobs and attract visitors. And we know that this is a growth sector, and those who work within in the industry also know there's room for improvement. Improvement in this respect can come in the form of promoting accessible tourism. We know that there is an economic benefit that can be gained from inclusive tourism too, and Visit Britain reveals around 12 billion is spent in this area and affects 18.5% of our total population. But this is more than just economic development to develop accessible tourism in Scotland. We need to make it happen, and we need to make it possible for everyone to access Scotland's wonderful tourist destinations. And it says on the government website, tourism is everyone's business. Everyone in Scotland is an ambassador, which of course leads to Jeremy Balfour's point that we should possibly have ambassadors to help deliver this improvement. I thus welcome the Scottish Government funding to deliver the aim, and we've heard that it can break barriers, whether it's technology or physical barriers, and many members have touched on the measures being implemented, such as the two new accessible tourism destinations in Fife and Edinburgh, and also producing a new guide to help event organisers to make their events more accessible. And also, really important is the development of a new website, an accessible guide website and promotional campaign. But I look forward to hearing further developments from Visit Scotland about their new programme and what they will be doing to encourage businesses to work in partnership with local authorities as well. But there's so much to be positive about. And Fiona Hyslop made an excellent point about a shared partnership between hospitality providers and local carers to offer respitality, which I have to admit I'd never heard of. And Ian Gray talked passionately about Lukey House, which is a wonderful respite centre based near North Berwick. And when I met Mary O'Keefe, who runs the centre, I actually said to her, do you know, this is more like a hotel. And she said, that is absolutely the ethos that we're trying to deliver. And Ian Gray's completely right about the fun aspect of Lukey House, because those with MS, MND and Parkinson's are treated to flights in the paragliders. And do you know, Mr. Gray, I would like to be the first person to donate £10 to your charity, because I'd love to see you in a paraglider. In fact, I'd quite like to come and visit.
I feel you've opened up a competition, Mr. Gray. You're doing well.
I'll see how Cheltenham goes. Tavish Scott spoke of the need for better parking and toilet facilities of Historic Scotland and attractions too. And Jeremy Balfour spoke about the problems of parking closer to a venue for people without a blue badge. And my colleague Jeremy Balfour also urged members to think carefully about the practicalities of delivering accessible tourism in historic and listed buildings. Presiding Officer, it's clear that we need to raise the awareness of inclusive tourism, and this isn't just the need to see it rolled out further, but we also need to highlight individuals who currently practice social tourism, but they don't publicise it. This also includes the programmes, events and activities that enable all groups of people from youth, families, retirees, individuals with modest incomes and individuals with restricted physical and mental capacity. But we want everybody to enjoy tourism. Alison Harris and Rhoda Grant spoke about the practicalities of delivering accessible and inclusive tourism. And I love a feather duvet, but Alison Harris makes a very good point about asthmatics, that they might not want a feather duvet. Surveys have shown that most organisations do not know they were involved in social tourism, as that would not have highlighted this. And this means that those searching for appropriate destinations are not getting full sight of those appropriate available destinations out there. David Torrance highlighted Guide Dog Scotland, and I too received the briefing yesterday. I think it's really important that in 2012, when Visit Scotland launched their initial accessible tourism project, their events were the most popular stakeholder events guide dog owners wished to participate in. So we must ensure that everybody is included in this. But by simply making people aware about what social tourism and accessible tourism is, we can see a concentrated effort to help more people with disabilities and those from disadvantaged backgrounds experience the joys of a Scottish holiday. Lewis MacDonald made an excellent contribution about Euan MacDonald's initiative, and I wish I'd met Euan too. And we've heard today that Euan's guide works really hard to try and raise awareness and remove the fear of the unknown, and provides a brochure that reviews the accessibility of locations and attractions. And I just looked at the website last night and found on my own doorstep Abbotsford House, which is near Melrose and Melrose Abbey, the John Gray Centre in Haddington, and the National Museum of Flight. But again, I go back to the idea of introducing ambassadors to help disabled people at venues and events, and I think that probably is quite a good idea. We've heard today about members and their local accessibility and social tourism venues, and we've heard about the Trossachs mobility benefits, the beach buggies on North Berwick Beach, the work done by Aberdeen Beach, the Family Holiday Association, Strathclyde Park, Hamilton Racecourse, and the up-and-coming V&A Museum. And we've heard many mention the benefits of a holiday, and we know that a holiday provides individuals and families with physical and mental health, as well as broader educational, cultural, and communal advantages. Sandra White said, everybody needs a break, which is a really important comment to make. I was also struck by Tavish Scott's comments about the impact of poverty on aspiration and hope, which kind of says it all. Holidays have the potential to tackle social inclusion, loneliness and isolation, as has been mentioned today. And this also reflects the value that our tourism community brings beyond our economic benefits. And I warmly welcome the generosity of the hospitality industry, who recently dug deep to help give a short break to those who ordinarily wouldn't be able to enjoy a holiday. Last year I lodged a motion to congratulate Visit Scotland initiatives, Spirit of Scotland and Breaking Barriers for Families. I wanted to recognise the advantages that the 300 people from disadvantaged backgrounds have had to, in going on a short break. And we've heard today of those who got involved, such as Hilton Hotels, and very often, these initiatives are successful when they are sector-led, as Dean Lockhart pointed out. We do think that the Labour amendment is fair and ask for the implementation of Section 179. And the section in question means that anyone applying for a licence has to state when what disabled access they have. And given it's already law and has been since 2010, we are happy to support it. We just would like to see what is happening with the implementation. Deputy Presiding Officer, These wider benefits are still not being experienced by one in three people who are unable to access them because of cost, ill health, or caring responsibilities. These are the groups of people that this type of tourism can help. And when helping, we will see the positive benefits that have been mentioned today in this chamber. Rightly, as Dean Lockhart's amendment makes clear, this focus should be for all, not just those who live in Scotland, but outside too. And we want to ensure Scotland remains a welcoming place for everyone, no matter where they're from or what disability they might have. And I support the motion in Dean Lockhart's name.
Thank you very much. I call Fiona Hyslop to close for the Government Cabinet Secretary 458, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I'm very pleased to respond to what has been a very thought-provoking and informative debate. Bill Bowman, I think, reflected that we've all learned something in this debate, and I think there's also been a generosity of spirit across the Chamber. That should reflect what we want from the spirit of Scotland in terms of how we should be as a nation, but also I think it's helped us identify what we can do and what we can aspire to. I think there's also been a sense of realism and challenge, and I think that's really important. So although there's been a lot of content about the good things and good examples, we should not let us think that somehow we should be satisfied with that, and I think that's the challenge that we have. I hope it's also been thought-provoking for everyone here in the Chamber, and increasingly the role of tourism has been recognised for the almost unique reach that it has across our economy, across our country in terms of place, and also across our society. And I hope that today has given a chance to see tourism in a new light. And I wanted to bring this debate here today because I wanted to shine a light on this area and to see what more we can do in terms of bringing the force of the support of the Parliament to spread the word, to recognise what's there, but to encourage more activity. One of the first visits I made as Cabinet Secretary for Tourism was to the Seagull Trust and their amazing work providing accessible canal-based tourism breaks. And again, I think that also reflects an attitude. This has got to be about can-do. And I think the can-do attitude that has been, I think, expressed through a number of contributions, I think has been very important in how we take this forward. Now, there are three amendments submitted in relation to today's motion. In relation to Dean Lockhart's amendment to further promote Scotland as an accessible destination, I'm very happy to support this, and our work to date is only the beginning of ensuring that Scotland is a destination for everyone. And I'm also happy to support Lewis MacDonald's amendment on making accessibility a condition of licensing applications. The Cabinet Secretary for Justice has already advised that work on the implementation of the Act will begin this year, and although there are secondary legislation issues, we will try to make sure that the work is taken forward as early as possible, and I will ask the relevant officials to keep Lewis MacDonald informed of progress. Turning to Tavish Scott's amendment, the ingenuity of Tavish Scott to get his constituency always into his debates, so I think is to be commended. But he raised an important point of the cost of travel, and we're working hard to support disabled families through our disability delivery plan, including addressing accessibility and providing decent incomes. Work to reduce ferry fares to the Northern Isles, I understand, is underway, and older and disabled islanders already received 2-3 return journeys to the mainland each year, and I'm happy to support the amendment. He also raised the issue around rates. So in terms of small business bonus in this sector, I understand half of premises won't pay rates at all. 8,500 will benefit from the cap that's been introduced, but also in relation to the Barclay Review, the Finance Secretary has already indicated that he's identified tourism. I'm also at my request to the Barclay Review. In terms of other areas, the wide range, I think, of benefits that inclusive tourism can bring helps the tourism industry. As we've heard, Alison Harris, I think, really made the point that the economic benefit of this has to be broadcast more widely to the tourism industry itself. The social and educational benefits we've heard of, and for families more widely. We also had a number of references to visit Flanders, and I thought was very struck me when I had my discussion with them was the genesis within the trade union movement. And it struck me listening to Sandra White about her experience of her family, experience of a family of 8 from Govan, and the support from the unions is perhaps something we should reflect on as we go forward with our venture in the social tourism area. But we can and should learn from other countries. But also if we're trying to tackle inequalities that exist in our society, we must look and identify what can be done. In terms of the simple perception of what we should do, it's also about making sure that doing something that is regular, like going out for a drink to our local, taking a day trip to museums or galleries, getting on a ferry, or whatever we do, we're trying to sort of think about how do we make sure that is something that is readily accessible for everyone. I think George Adams' personal reflections were very, very helpful in giving us a sense of what that many people face. I think in terms of, we know from Euan's Guide, and Paul and Ryan, I think from Euan's Guide are here today, they only know too well of the impact of these barriers. But I think if you look at the reviews that were referred to, and I think Rhoda Grant, as a recognising that Highlands and Islands, there needs to be more reviews from there, represented her constituency and the challenges very well. But if you take the review of the Theatre Royal in Glasgow, a building I've been involved in as Cabinet Secretary for Funding, Glasgow's oldest theatre, or the Fife Voluntary Action Premises, you can see a difference that removing some of the barriers can make. The website itself also aims to be accessible to the widest range of people, regardless of technology or ability. In relation to some of the other points, and I thought Sandra White, perhaps in her thinking about how do you tackle the issue of poverty in particular, Richard Lyle, Tavish Scott again, and John Mason all referred to this, talked about what we might want to do and think about in terms of what we do with and for children. 2018 is Scotland's Year of Young People, and it will aim to inspire Scotland through its young people to celebrate their achievements, create new opportunities for them to shine. And many of those opportunities could come from our tourism industry. So whether it's the opportunity to travel beyond their own area, see something out of the ordinary, do something different at school, or the opportunity to take a break from caring or other responsibilities. These can make a huge difference to the lives of young people. And I just wonder whether we should collectively challenge ourselves in 2018, the Year of Young People, to think about what we can do. Sandra White referred to the Child Poverty Bill. That's obviously another minister's responsibility. But I do think if we set our mind to thinking of our ambition for what we expect for our young people, we certainly should address that. In terms of references to contributions, Dean Lockhart mentioned the Trossachs mobility. I'm very keen and interested to learn more. I've met one of the individuals involved, and I was very inspired by what I heard. Lewis MacDonald made a very important point about getting behind champions. It's not what we do or what government can say or do. We can provide support. We can do things in terms of legislation, but I think we should really get behind our champions. He mentioned Judith Schofield, for example, and Dame Anne Begg. And in relation to Tavish Scott, you mentioned Jarlshof, and I do think in terms of those points, I will raise them with Historic Environment Scotland, and I hope they can respond directly to him. But I think it's also important to recognise what is being done. And Historic Environment Scotland, all their staff sites that were open in March took part in Disabled Access Day for the first time. And again, I think that's, we're seeing that with a number of our collections, our institutions. Also, in relation to Historic Environment Scotland, they have procured two new mobility vehicles for Edinburgh and Stirling Castles to help activity there. David Torrance, I thought, was thoughtful in talking about unlocking potential, and I think that actually unlocking potential both of tourism businesses, but also for individuals, I think is a key part of our perspective. Jeremy Balfour introduced the concepts of our roller coaster analysis here, but he did say something I thought was quite interesting about basic things around near access parking. It occurred to me that having used some time ago parent and child parking at supermarkets, perhaps some of our visitor institutions could think about something like that for near access parking in terms of activity. And in terms of ambassadors, we can look at that, but also we'll draw to his attention some of the customer excellence schemes that already exist. And I think George Adam referred particularly to access panels as well. John Mason, I think, brought to life the real heart of this debate in terms of social tourism and reflected on the real impact on real individuals and particularly on children. And I think reflecting the feedback of those that have been involved in the social tourism have been very important. And Ian Gray, there we are, Euan, your Euan Green's champion of Lookie House was really inspiring, actually. And I think your microflight challenge, I think, is one that I'm sure everybody in the chamber would want to help support. But he made an important point about families, and I think that's the model of care that he talked about in Lookie House. And I think that reflects everything we've been talking about. We can't just treat individuals with either disabilities or those that need care on their own. They're part of our society and they're part of families. And I think looking at it from that perspective would be helpful. Again, from the tourism businesses, quite frequently when people go on holiday, they're taking somebody with them, and that's, again, additional expenditure. John Finney talked about a rights-based approach for this, and I thought that was a very important part of the debate. And I think that also ties in with young people and children and the debate that Sandra White brought into the discussion. George Adam talked about the town halls and football stadiums, and I think there is a challenge with older buildings in reflection to the town halls, but I'm very conscious in my own constituency in Linlithgow, a very old building, the Borough Halls, has been refurbished and restored, but in a very accessible way as well. Very practical things that are talked about. Rhoda Grant talked about colour coding as well. And there was very much a focus in some of the latter debates on some of the equality networks issue for LGBT visitors on Wish You Were Here. But the real theme, I think, of our debate has to be about how can we make sure Scotland is more welcoming, to make sure they're more welcoming for all. And if we're serious about our economic strategy and inclusive growth as being part and parcel of Scotland's society and our economic activity, I think there is no better argument and no better case than that of tourism being able to drive, as a key sector in our economy, that inclusive growth agenda. Presiding Officer, I think perhaps the most important statistic for me in relation to the ScotSpirit Breaks we've heard is that 98% of children had fun and created happy memories. That is a personal and perfect outcome, I'm sure. And we want to create happy memories, we want to create resilience, we want this to be the sort of country that we want to live in, to make sure that we do have that warm welcome, that we're accessible for all. And if this debate has done anything to help contribute to that agenda, I'm very grateful for the contributions. And I think collectively we can be very pleased about not only the tone, but also the content and the inspiration that many of the speeches during this debate have given us today.